are listening to Spaceboy Universe on the SBU Network.
Explore the universe with Spaceboy and Surlana.
32 minutes, 21 seconds. 5 second tone followed by a 1 second pause.
You are listening to Spaceboy Universe.
Okay, gang, let's go. Let's go.
Texas, welcome to Spaceboy Universe, featuring Spaceboy and the lovely Surlana. So strap in and prepare for launch sequence.
Greetings and salutations, I'm Spaceboy.
I'm Surlana.
And this is Spaceboy Universe. It is December 10th, 2016, and tonight's special guest is Patrick Sporer, a.k.a. the Precog, and we'll take your calls. As always, follow us on Twitter, at the SB Universe, follow Surlana, at Surlana, and follow me, Spaceboy, at Spaceboy Music. Also, remember, you can check us out on the SBUNetwork.com. Remember to use your hashtags tonight. Do hashtag SB Universe and hashtag Space Cadets. Want to hang out with the Space Cadets? Well, no problem. Do that by going to spaceboyuniverse.com. Click on the dancing chat bubble at the top, and that will get you in with all the cool kids. In addition to Twitter, you can find the universe on Facebook, Tumblr, SoundCloud, iTunes, and YouTube. Just look for Spaceboy Universe. Speaking of YouTube, you can find more than the Spaceboy Universe archive of shows. There's video content from Spaceboy Music, video interviews, 2-bit gamers, and so much more. Can't catch the show live? No problemo. Take the SBU on the go with you via Spreaker, SoundCloud, and iTunes, because we love to broadcast. And how are you, the lovely Surlana?
Oh, I'm enjoying the chat room. It's just already hopping. We got our usual suspects in there.
Our usual motley crew?
Yep. Hey, James Cruz.
Yeah, let's see here. Yes, that looks like it's going to be a good night tonight. And, you know, we've got one of our favorite guests on tonight, mm-hmm. Patrick Sporer, which
a pro when it comes to being a guest.
Yes, he definitely, you know, knows his P's and Q's.
Could run his own show.
Yes, very, very much indeed.
He's very much capable, I think.
So, you know, Surlana, I don't know if it's like pulling teeth, but it's always this part of the show is like banter.
And banter is so difficult. Mm-hmm. Because you have to research it, and I'm like, I'm not interested in 80% of this stuff, and it's just hard.
Mm-hmm. Just a quick sound test, everyone out there. How does Surlana sound? Does she sound okay?
I don't sound like I'm on.
Yeah, well, could you adjust your mic a little bit?
How did that get like that?
Yeah, well, it was pizza night, you know. So.
Oh, man.
Oh, there you go.
Yes.
I can hear you.
I couldn't let that get in the way of pizza.
Yeah, so pizza night, we had some Coke Zeros to go with it.
Oh, so good.
And pretty delicious.
Parmesan bites.
Oh, yes. Those were. We ordered Domino's tonight. We haven't done a Domino's thing in a long time.
And maybe because it has been a long time, but for some reason it was just exceptionally good.
Yeah, it was good. And surprisingly, like, I was a little worried about, like, an hour or 2 hours before the show we were getting kind of headachy, probably allergy related. How are you doing better?
My eyes were burning. My left eye. Oh, my God, my left eye. It looked like I'd been in a fight. It was completely red and irritated, but I think it might have been because we took our cat to the vet, and she's got some, she's having an allergic reaction to flea bites, and we had to get her all, you know, all the hairs coming out. And it was like, she probably sheds an extra pound of hair when we try to get her in the cat carrier. You know, you know, cats spring five extra pairs of legs when you go to put them in a carrier.
They are pretty interesting.
Her back legs she had six more back legs, you know.
It was funny.
I was like, turn it upside down. Hold it. Hold it.
And on the flip side, you know, we had gave her some scratching medicine that which was great, because usually in the past when we've given it to her,
flea med.
Yeah, flea med. But usually in the past when we've given it to
it's
her,
topical.
It's like she spazzes out. But today, I said I got a game plan. So while she was all trying to be lovely, you know, lovey next to you, and you know, in her little chair that she sits next to you while you do your Photoshop and stuff like that, I went up from behind and got her.
I like that, because you get to be the bad guy.
Well, she didn't even realize that the
not till the smell hit, and then she busted down your barrier you put up in front of the dog door.
Yes,
she like tore through that. It was pretty funny.
Yeah, it was pretty funny. But yeah, we took care of Muffin, and so she's good.
I know I am allergic to cats, so stupid me for having a cat, but she's worth it. I'll sneeze my head off if I need
to. Well, James Cruz apparently has a full house there. He's got four and a dog.
Is that four cats and a dog?
Oh, that's, yeah. And then Bob, God, I have, you know, in the old days, I used to order from these, like, mom and pop pizza stores. And, and there was a time where my stepfather and I, we would order a 21-inch pizza and go to town on that. But I'm sure 21-inch pizza would probably kill me now. So, yeah.
We split a medium.
Yeah,
it's like four for you, four for me.
Yeah, 14-inch. You know, that's reasonable, you know. And I actually ate two slices and then put the other two in the fridge because, you know, I love breakfast pizza. And Solana looks at me like I'm crazy, but there's nothing better than cold pizza.
Apparently,
the next
day. I'm the only person in the universe that does not eat cold pizza that has to have it reheated.
Well, I don't.
And I like reheating it in the oven because it comes back to being crispy again.
Well, I don't like. I'll eat it right out of the fridge, cold, and you know.
I don't know if that's just what people do, or it's because you're from another.
No, I'm not alone in this. There's other people out there that eat their pizza cold right out of the refrigerator. I mean, you know, like
you
know,
the
day after.
How do you eat the cheese all congealed like that? I don't get it.
It's all chewy, babe. I mean, it's not like it's. I mean, it's not a bad cheese chewy kind of thing. But yeah, see, there's Bob. Bob agrees with me. I got Bob on my side. I'm sure Bev is probably the anti person in this situation, but at least Bob is on my side.
He says Bev's on the way, I think.
Yeah, so good. But apparently pizza for breakfast, yum yum. And Bob, you know, you're in my court on this.
I don't object to pizza for breakfast. I just want it heated.
Yeah, well, you like most things like extremely hot. I take the
unless it's ice cream.
I'm terrible when it comes to eating stuff cold, especially like right out of the freezer. Taquitos. We've bought taquitos before, and I've eaten taquitos right out of the box, out of the freezer. And you look at me like I'm crazy, and it's like kind of like
that's not right.
I look at it as like a taquito pop, and you know, it's not ice cream, it's not you know, a snow cone or anything. It's just a frozen taquito, and you know, so I know it's strange, but yeah, cold pizza, yes, James, is the shiznit. So, yeah, so there we go. Pizza. It's not for dinner anymore. It's for breakfast.
I've had it many a time, you know, the next day after ordering, but I put it in the oven. Mm-hmm. It's good.
Dennis is saying cold chicken nuggets as well.
Oh, what's the matter with y'all?
Yeah,
oh, so, my goodness.
Well, I could go for, you know, well, there's been, you know, there are times when I've eaten, you know, when we buy some stuff. And then I'll just put it in the freezer and then eat it cold the next day.
Oh, another thing you do.
Yeah.
Another thing you do is like if I'm putting frozen tater tots out, you know, to cook them.
Guilty.
You'll just walk over there and eat one right out of the bag. And I'm like, what is wrong with you?
Well, you know, and this is going to sound terrible, but, you know, I'll put the tot in my mouth and it defrosts in my mouth. And I know this is bizarre as I'm saying this, but, yeah, I'll eat the tot that way and then kind of chew it up. I know, I'm strange.
You ain't right.
Just like, for example.
You are not right.
People, you might think I'm strange on this one or not, but I like ketchup chip sandwiches. you know,
I have seen you put things between two slices of bread. I didn't know it was humanly possible.
But yeah, but ketchup chip sandwiches are awesome. Yeah. And you know, so but and then of course yeah, so yeah, ketchup chip sandwiches.
I mean I've seen you eat it and I'll look at you like, I can't believe I married you. Yeah. I really can't.
I know it's a
James Cruz peanut butter and Doritos sandwiches. Oh my goodness.
I don't know if I could eat that. I think that's a little bit beyond me.
But I'm
going
to think twice about meeting you in person.
But cheers to you, my friend, James. You've taken the food challenge to a new level. And so let's see.
Mustard and saltine cracker sandwiches. Well, that's not too strange.
Not too strange, yeah. And then Bob Yeppers, ketchup. See, another Bob thing is in my court.
Bob's now bucking for biggest fan.
He's a long-lost brother. And, you know, so...
They're actually, weirdly enough, all this talk is just making me want some chips, which we don't have because we ate them all.
Well, there's grocery shopping tomorrow if we get up early enough to go do.
If I get to have a nap, I'll get up. I did not want to get up from today's nap. I was about ready to sock you.
Well, you know, I said let's do an hour. And did I give you an hour?
I don't know.
I gave you more than an hour. And when you started to saw down the forest, I got worried that you were going to go too deep into your sleep.
I really thought about slapping you across the face when you tapped my arm. And I was like, well, I guess that wouldn't be fair.
It's always interesting when I say, babe. And then you're like, the whole bed shakes and you like freak out because like I'm like
startled
to death. And like, and it's like, oh,
I came back from another universe, you know.
He's waking me up again. Where's my knife?
No, it's like I've been somewhere else and you're bringing me back to reality and I'm startled.
It is like that. It's like you've been out of body experiencing and you come back and you realize that.
Something I'll have to talk to Patrick about. Hopefully he knows to call.
He's always, you know, Patrick Sporer is always the one who listens in the, like in the darkness while everyone's around the campfire. Those little red eyes are peering in.
Come on now.
No, I mean it in a good way. So peanut butter and mayonnaise. Now my grandfather.
Oh no, you've crossed the line.
Hold on, Fran. Let's adjust this real quick.
Somebody's crossed the line.
And my grandfather would love. Banana, mayonnaise, tortilla, those three together, and he would eat that. And sometimes he would put peanut butter on there without the mayonnaise. But
so, what planet is he from?
Well, it's probably the planet my rich ancestry is from. I'm the prince of this long lost civilization that had to come to Earth. And
Omicron Percy, I ate, I guess.
Exactly. You know, speaking of space, Surlana.
Now, chicken and waffles are just good.
You know, unfortunately, this week we had the death of John Glenn.
Yes.
He passed away at the age of 95. And, you know, what a great American as far as the space race was concerned. If you ever get a chance, one movie that stands out in my mind is The Right Stuff that was, the 1980s. It's a pretty long movie. But,
yeah.
But it is definitely a good movie. And, you know, it's... sad to see heroes like that go because, you know, they meant so much for the beginning of the space race and getting us into space. And now space is like so common that there's, you don't get the younger generation going, wow, that's cool. But he would definitely be missed, whether it was being in space or serving in Washington. And then, of course, you know, later in life.
That's right. He was a senator, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was a senator. And later in life, he got a chance to get on the space shuttle. Yeah. A lot of people were mad because they were saying he was just using his influence to get back up there and to have one last chance in space.
Well, I think it's his right and his privilege.
Mm-hmm. I can't think of anybody better, to go back into space than John Glenn, and he will be, missed. But that reminds me of another astronaut, and sometimes I wonder if this astronaut's not lost his marbles. I was reading this article about Buzz Aldrin going to the South Pole, and apparently he got sick or something, and they snatched him out of there, and When he came back, apparently he says that he saw evil itself and that we're all doomed in this article. Now, what's interesting about this article is, one, it sounds cool, like from it picks my brain like, oh, wow, that sounds cool, until you get to the end of the article. And I've seen this particular website before. It's called superstation95.com. And now, have you did anything or looked up anything about this?
Well, when you told me about it, first of all, that sounds squirrely for website name. Mm-hmm. I looked it up several things. There's a YouTube video that is, it doesn't have audio. It's just, I hate these videos that's just text inside of video, no audio.
Right.
But this particular video says that is a fake sensational news site.
Fake.
I guess kind of like the Inquirer and that places
right.
like that.
Right.
So it's be taken with a huge grain of salt. Probably grab you a salt lick and read, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Which is kind of a shame because when I read it, I was like, oh, wow, what did they see down there? I could see him going down there. Like
He is an admirer of what's the famous expedition that went down there?
I knew you were going to throw that one at me. And
I can't think of any of it. And he supposedly one of the guys went out, says, oh, I'm going to go out. I'll be some time. And the guy never came back. And
I remember that. That was an interesting.
But he's an admirer of those explorers.
Right.
So it's plausible to me that he would have gone down there and that he may have had a health issue. But as to what he said, it's hard to know if that's, a direct quote or not. But let's think about the conspiracy theories that are surrounding, isn't it supposedly there's supposed to have been a Nazi base down there?
Yeah, Admiral Byrd.
Admiral Byrd.
Yeah, went down there and they encountered UFOs. And
thank you, Bob.
An attack. And that is an interesting thing. Apparently the Germans escaping or building a base.
And experiments down there.
In the eventuality that if the Third Reich had been taken out by, at the end of the
supposedly,
war.
Supposedly there's an alien portal down there or maybe a stargate or aliens beneath the ice. Or,
It's hard to, because it's interesting you bring up Stargate because, there were tie-ins in the show where there was a gate in Antarctica on the show. And then you hear things.
Yes.
And then you hear back things with Admiral Byrd and all that stuff, and it makes you wonder: are we being told the truth through a television series, or is this just made up because they're borrowing from the television series?
Is it art imitating life or life imitating art, or are they preconditioning us to accept certain things using the media and movies and television? And books to get it in our minds so we can be more accepting or knowledgeable.
Well, this goes back to the conversation that we had. How can you tell the truth when you're not sure the truth is being told to you?
Yeah, you know the truth if you're told it? I mean, how will you find out?
Well, I guess the only way is to research it yourself and go find the truth for yourself. My only worry on that is that sometimes going to look for the truth will give you knowledge that will change your perception of reality to a point where could it break your psychosis and,
Yeah, I'm trying to think about it. It says it's pure evil. They're trying to kill us. Maybe they found a portal to hell. You never know.
You never know. So
maybe the penguins revolted.
So that goes back to what we were talking about, the Superstation 95, is that definitely, with a little bit of, looking in and looking for the truth in the story, you can find that the truth of the story is not necessarily always true.
No.
Even though it seems cool and spectacular and might support your paradigm, it may not be the part that you want supported. So there you go. Hey, speaking of portals, let's take ourselves to what McDonald's is doing.
Okay, I got one for you after that.
First, I heard the rumor that they're developing waffle fries, and I think that's up in Canada for our Canada listeners, for the Great White North. They're trying to develop waffle fries.
Like it's hard to develop waffle fries. Well, like Chick-fil-A ain't been doing that since the dawn of Chick-fil-A.
I don't really know if Chick-fil-A is up in Canada or not.
Well,
but the thing is, McDonald's is experimenting with waffle fries. And now I read another article as they're thinking about introducing tots, tater tots. You know, I love tots.
Yeah, but I mean, again, Sonic and Burger King already been doing that since, you know, how long? Sonic has always had tots.
Mm-hmm.
Burger King introduced them, I don't know, maybe 3-4 years ago.
Well, the thing is that not to, you know, they're not, well, necessarily, well, now, if you think of McDonald's and Burger King here in America, at least, they're going to be tots across the nation. But in other places, they may not have tots or waffle fries. I mean, that's a luxury, you know.
I can get waffle fries Monday through Thursdays at work because there is a Chick-fil-A Express in the building.
The point I'm trying to make here is that I'm good with tots.
They're pretty good.
Yeah, I like tots. But you know one thing?
But the Burger King tots are cheesy tots. Well, so they got just, a little cheese in them.
They just brought cheesy tots back to Burger King.
Yeah, they did. They got the little cheese spooge in them and, you know.
And those are quite tasty, to say the least.
Yeah.
And it's for a limited time only. Not that I'm doing a plug for Burger King, but.
Oh, my gosh. We have frozen hush puppies in the freezer, and I totally forgot.
What night was those supposed to be made?
I don't know, but I'm thinking they're going to get made real soon.
So it's not a cookie night. It's
we could put the hush puppy in the middle of the cookie.
Okay, whatever. I guess good news in this sense, I believe that Kim Kardashian is divorcing Kanye West.
Oh, who cares?
So we're moving on.
I got one.
Shoot.
So I can't figure out all the details on this. Oh, hey, Dino. But, you know,
oh, hi, Mark.
Oh, hi, Mark. You don't know that reference. You're lucky. My favorite thing in the whole world, Amazon.com, is going to have a beta test physical store. And I think it's going to be like in Seattle somewhere.
Yes.
And from what I can see in the video, now I'm going to guess you've already got an Amazon account. You've already got your charged up with money or something. So you walk into the store and you put it on your phone and you scan something on your phone and you go through the turnstiles or whatever, and you just walk in there, you pull things off the shelf, put it in your buggy, put it in your bag, and you just walk out.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
And you're using technology where it's face recognition, focuses on your eyes. They've got
kind of spooky.
They've got chips embedded into the products. And but this fast pay thing, they already kind of have it. Like, for example, whenever I buy a movie from Amazon, I have a one-click setting where it automatically bills my card for that transaction. So, considering how much business that Amazon does and how well they are at tracking packages and all that stuff, I can only make sense out of this whole thing that the little mini marts are going to be something that they're wanting to roll out. They already have 1-hour service. Amazon Prime Now.
We got stuff in under 2 hours.
Under 2 hours.
Because there's a depot here.
We got
Houston.
Ice cream and some other
goodies. We got 2 pints of ice cream, a bag of candy, and a desk calendar just to be weird.
Yeah.
And it worked.
Yeah, within a couple of hours, and we didn't have to go anywhere. That was kind of nice. In the sense that not having to go to a Walmart, which, you know, I can't tell you how much of a drag it is to go to a Walmart.
Yeah, but since they brought back the self-checkout, it's less of a hassle.
Like, for example, today it was like, go, go, go. So we run into Walmart.
I know, it was like a military,
And then we went through the checkout because, you know, first off, our Walmart had like, I guess, 20 checkout lanes. And usually there were only 3 people out of the 20.
And, you know, people talk about that. It's in stand-up routines. It's a joke. You know, it's a well-known joke. But it is the bald-faced truth. Walk in there and look.
And then wait 5 hours to get checked out. But now our Walmart has self-checkout again. Because when we first moved to our location, they had self-checkout. And then they took it away. And then they made it.
They remodeled it into a super Walmart.
A super Walmart.
Because it wasn't one before.
It was a regular
old school Walmart.
And then they expanded it for groceries and all. And they did all this thing. And so it's now got all these wonderful self-checkout things that you come in and, I mean, would you say now that they have that, are
we could get out of there faster.
We're getting out of there faster, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I would agree there.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's like bing, bing, bing. And it reminds me of my old days when I used to be a checker for Winn-Dixie. But that's another story altogether.
I went in there and said, look, I don't want to hang around. I don't want to look anything. We're going straight to the back. We're getting this, this, this. And we're going to get that. You're going to look for this. And then we're getting out.
And, you know, and I really think the air in there, when you stay too long in there, I really get sick. You know, every time I get in there, especially as we make our way to the back, and then I start feeling like nauseated from, I don't know, the air or whatever. But, yeah, so I'm just...
And the people in there, I got nowhere to go, nothing to do, and you're like, get out of the way!
Right.
You just can't take it.
So, that's why I think we love Amazon, is because, you know, you can do your shopping in your underwear, and you don't have to worry about somebody taking a picture of you and posting it on the people of Amazon.
Well, as long as you've got your camera covered on your...
Well, I've got my camera
covered. I got my tape over all these laptops.
You know, I just want to tell everybody tonight, if you call in tonight, we have swag for you tonight.
Any caller. You don't have to be first time.
First time. Last time. We hope not. The first three callers tonight, we're going to give you Solaris Blue Raven's new book, A Million Miles to Midnight.
That's a print copy.
It's a print copy.
So you will need to be emailing an address.
Address. And then, of course, after, you know, if there's more people that call in, we still have a lot of these Funko Pops to give out. Tanner, sorry we didn't get yours out this week, but...
we got lots of things we need to mail.
Yeah, so it'll
be... We now have Spaceboy Universe, or SBU Network, either one, now has a P.O. box, and y'all know about that.
Yeah, we'll probably by next week. Also, starting next week, Spaceboy Music moves to Saturday nights. And what that means for you, the listener, is an hour before the universe starts, you'll get to jam out to Spaceboy music, and the show will be back-to-back with the universe now. So we're going to be moving from Thursday nights to Saturday nights, and that's going to open up the SBU network for other possibilities that we're trying to build up here at the SBU network. But as it stands, Spaceboy music... Back to back with Spaceboy Universe, so that'll be a lot of fun, won't it, Surlana?
Yes, it will be for me.
All right. Means early nights to go to bed, maybe.
Yeah, it's more convenient for me, basically, what all that means.
So, let's see, what else before we get this mega break going and get Patrick Sporer on board? Anything else you can think of?
We've started watching Westworld. Mm-hmm. I watched the first three episodes, then you plowed ahead and binge-watched it. Now I'm like, I guess that means I haven't watched it anymore.
Well, you should watch it because there's going to be another season.
It was interesting. Like, I never saw the original movie with Yul Brynner, but I was aware of it and I knew what it was about, but I never saw it. I know this is loosely based on that, but it's taking it up a notch. It's an interesting premise. The way they're handling it is odd. It's like they're... storytelling in a circle. It goes around and around and around, and it's almost
they've looped it because they reset the park. Mm-hmm. So for when visitors come, they can follow a storyline, and then they kind of do that where everybody does the same thing and they're all programmed to follow a certain line and not deviate too much from that storyline. And of course it gets more detailed as some of the androids or whatever you want to call them become more self-aware.
I can tell where this is trying to go, and I'm like, well, this is interesting, but I'm like, y'all do know that this is already explored on Star Trek, pick a show, but Measure of a Man, Star Trek, Star Trek The Next Generation.
Well, on that magical note, let's go ahead and take our break while we acquire our guest Patrick Sporer, which will be back after this. And that is not what I wanted to play. give me a second here while I look here. I guess we'll just do this. Thank you. Welcome back. And let me pull up my bio here. Patrick Sporer, a.k.a. the Precog. He has been a precognitive clairvoyant dreamer and intuitive since childhood. It is possible that this ability may have been triggered by a head or neck accident which coincided with contact with another worldly being. He has been recording his dreams and studying them for over 35 years. He has discovered that his dreams provide previews of all sorts of future events. Since 2007, 9 years ago, he has been posting dreams and repetition phenomenon to his
cognition.
Thank you. Experiment. Blog posted with date and time before those events occur. This has resulted in stunning news and Florida Lotto Jackpot combo results with consistency. His blog address is patrick-patrickscott.blogspot.com, which, Patrick, we need to talk to you about getting your own domain.
Yeah.
He served in the U.S. Army, and thank you for your service, sir. He has been featured on Fox News and has also appeared on ESPN and Good Morning America, as well as featured in a national, in national magazines and local news publications. He was involved in the fitness industry, where he competed as a national level bodybuilder, owned his own bodybuilding gym, promoted events, was a national level physique judge, model, and a real life magic mic. Click, click with the eye. In addition, he has worked as a professional intuitive reader. Some might call him a psychic for 20 years. He is also a certified hypnotist. He is going to talk about how to foretell the future via dreams, signs, symbols, and synchronicity, and other things dealing with the power of the subconscious mind. Please welcome our guest tonight, Patrick Sporer.
Wow.
That was a mouthful.
It was. Thank you.
before we get into just real quick, Patrick, if you don't mind my asking, the photo you sent us to use, is that recent photo of you or...?
Not too far back. That's very similar to how I appear now.
Because I was like, man, you're fabulous. I'm inspired to look that good.
I need to send you my Playgirl layout.
Uh-oh.
I like that.
Oh, God. Oh, man, that's awesome.
Well,
if
I'm on in the future, we'll post one of those.
I'm sure our guest will be tickled pink.
I'll get a chuckle at it, but
there's definitely all of these things. Even how that came off was a synchronicity, something that just came out of the blue. But we can talk about that at another time. Anyway, I want to welcome all of your space cadets, as always, to the show.
Mm-hmm. And they welcome
you,
sir.
I want to thank both of you, Spaceboy and Surlana, for having me on as a guest again.
Well, you're definitely one of our favorites that we like to talk to. So,
but we need to get you a domain name bot so you can point your blog at your domain name so people can get to you faster.
Well, I've been thinking about that, but I just have to figure out what to do, because I was reading about that a couple years ago, and they said if you do that, you might lose people that are used to coming to your address.
No, they could still go to that address, mm-hmm. and you could also. Mm-hmm. Point you just it's the back end, you go and you point the .com at the blog, so they're both the same thing,
so you're not losing
and,
anything.
Spaceboy can tell you how to do all that.
In fact we should talk some more about this
when you have time
and we'd love to, you know, Surlana and I would love to put our brains together for
because
you,
because people would be able to find you faster. You'd have a nice clean URL that's branded to your name or something similar to the Precog. Mm-hmm. That way they can find you, but you could keep it on your blog spot if you want to.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I'm open for ideas. Always.
Cool.
I appreciate that. Yeah. But what I was going to tell you is, prior to the show tonight, I was watching something on Netflix, and Spaceboy, you may have seen it. It's called For the Love of Spock. Have you seen that yet?
No.
We wanted to watch it together.
Yeah, it's one of those ones that I don't want to watch before because Surlana has been mentioning, oh, I want to see that. Mm-hmm. But I do know about it in the sense that it's...
It was his son putting it together.
Exactly, and it's definitely something that I've heard is hits you right in the heart, and so it's something we want to share together.
Well, good. Yeah, his son, Adam, directed it. Mm-hmm. It. You know, there's a lot of stuff I didn't know. I mean, it is really well done. It's about 90 minutes long, and mm-hmm. I recommend it to everybody if you haven't seen it. And it's new to Netflix, and I just happened to catch it before the show tonight, and I said, well, I wanted to bring that up to you because I know all of us are fans from way back.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
The original Star Trek series. And I think, don't you have a man crush on John Cena?
Who, me? Or
yeah,
her.
You, aren't you? No, you.
I think there's a lot of...
There's a lot of memes out there.
Memes out there that are pretty funny. John Cena!
Oh, yeah. Dun, 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 dun. Well, I was going to say, he's hosting Saturday Night Live tonight.
Oh, okay.
That's the only reason I brought it up. I'm always thinking of other people, and I write little notes, and I say, well, I remember Spaceboy mentioning John Cena, so...
Yeah, I think it should be pretty funny. Usually on the SNL, now that they post like clips now, like the day after and mm-hmm. stuff, that's usually when I catch it, you know. And
the only thing you show me, Spaceboy, there is you had me listen to a YouTube audio clip where a radio station pranked this woman.
Oh, that was.
And it was a John Cena thing.
It was pretty funny.
Yeah.
And the woman just, what happened was that she apparently owed some kind of bill at least that's what they were pranking her. And every time they'd call back and, you know, it'd be like,
voice.
It'd be a real person talking to him. And then all of a sudden they'd hit the John Cena thing and,
her husband set it up.
Yes. That's
she pranked her.
And so it was quite hilarious in the sense that the woman
just called the cops.
She was, yeah, like, oh, it was really bad.
Yeah, people do some, you know, that pranking out there. Sometimes it's funny, and sometimes some people take it really serious.
Yeah, like
strange things happen there. You know, last week when I was listening to your show, you know, it was about David Bowie. And by the way, I really loved your rendition of Space Oddity.
Oh, thank you, appreciate it.
Yeah, but it cut off there at the end. You said you didn't expect that, correct?
Yeah, it was weird how it just cut off, and apparently I must have picked the wrong song. I mean, I have, you know, when I do when I do my work for music, you know, I'll do a demo, and then it might not be a complete, and then, there is usually the final cut. And I must have picked the demo one that
picked the wrong file.
I picked the wrong file, but I mean, you got the idea, and but yeah, if you liked it, that's great. I did a distortion on purpose to kind of give the feel of like a radio to Major Tom kind of thing, and going back and forth, and that's why some of the distortions in that, and especially in my voice.
You know. It's always interesting talking to you two guys because it seems like we're on a natural frequency sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the things that we discussed. There was something I saw. Back to the For the Love of Spock. When you watch it, the thing I love about well-done documentaries, and this one is very well done and very heartfelt, it shows you the foreshadowing early in their careers before they hit it big.
Hmm.
And that's always, you'll see as you watch these things, that's what I love about well-done documentaries, because you'll see that these people, you know, like Leonard Nimoy had been, he'd been acting since 1949.
Oh, yeah.
People are unaware of that. Yeah.
Yes.
They think he just suddenly came into the Spock role, and no, it was a series of events that brought that to him. But anyway, we'll
move on from that.
I wanted to ask you.
I was going to say real quick, yeah, he basically kind of like he would do a role and he didn't know how long it was going to be. You know, it was usually a lot of the roles that it just end abruptly or it wouldn't last very long. And eventually he met his destiny with Star Trek.
Well, also he did an episode, I think, of the original Outer Limits. When he, you know, prior to the, you remember the old series, The Outer Limits?
Oh, yeah.
The old one,
yeah.
One from the 60s, and then they redid it on Showtime. I think Showtime was really well done, too.
Yeah, that was done.
But what was interesting about that is Leonard Nimoy was in one of the original Outer Limits, And then later, during the Showtime series, his son directed, they ended up directing the same one.
I think, wasn't it iRobot?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. It was pretty interesting.
Uh-huh.
But I wanted to ask you, any luck on your dog?
No, unfortunately, you know, to be frank with you and our audience, this is that moment like last week when I was saying I will always be honest with you, whether it be good or bad. No trace. We've did everything electronically out there where, you know, to get people to kind of keep an eye out. And unfortunately, where we live on a, I guess, a dead end street. And beyond that is fields and
just a small field with some trees.
I mean, we're right next to a major area where there's coyotes and there's snakes.
Yeah.
There's a levee. And, you know, we're talking about my dog is an elderly dog.
He's totally deaf.
Totally deaf. Heart,
nearly blind.
Nearly blind.
Clumsy.
And, yeah, so
he didn't stand a chance.
If indeed he, you know, I really think that he could have made his maker, met his maker. And it's kind of sad in the sense that for us, you know, realizing that that's it. There's no more tick foo in our life. And I was talking to Surlana today about how there have been times by myself where I've cried and been upset. And she knows that I've been depressed about this, but trying to keep an outward appearance of, you know, upbeat appearance is very difficult. But it's going to take a lot of time for me to get over this. But.
Well, now when the cat goes, you'll probably have to put me in a hospital for a while.
Yeah.
So I won't be able to hold it together.
You sent me a photo, and I shared it with a number of friends to see if they could put it on their Facebook site.
Sure.
But is that a pug, or is that
yes.
a bulldog?
That's a pug.
He's just old.
That's a pug, yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah, I thought it was. Okay, but you know what's interesting about this? I'm segueing into something about missing things.
When
I see these missing person cases that suddenly come up on the news, some of them I'll tune into, and I tuned into the one with Sherry Papini. Are you aware of her?
No, I don't think I'm familiar with her.
Okay, this is a huge story. I mean, this is huge because she went missing on, I think it was November 2nd, and immediately.
Is this the jogger?
Yeah, the jogger.
Yes,
the blonde
I am familiar
from
with
California,
it. Mm-hmm.
Northern California, yes. And her name's Sherry Papini. And what's interesting about this is that I will make a card just like I do for my lotto, just like I do for, you know, when I dream about celebrities or individuals.
Mm-hmm.
As you well know, I make lotto cards on. And also on these missing persons, what I've been experimenting with is making up information. So I started writing all her information down from the site that they had. And then what I do is I just sort of, for lack of a better term, sleep on it, as you might say.
Right.
See what kind of dreams are going to come up. So I had a dream, like I think it was that night or the next night, I saw her in not a hotel, but a motel room. She was on her knees. She was bound. And I noticed her hair was shorter. But I saw two males, and I had a very good description. And here's what happened. I waited to post that, and I made the post, the actual dream post about that, 3 days before she was found on Thanksgiving Day.
Yeah.
And at that time when I posted that, I said, well, I have a feeling that we're going to get an updated information. She's either going to show up or there's going to be news about her not maybe being alive. And then there you went. On Thanksgiving Day, she was found. Now, it's very interesting that of all the days they could have found her, it was actually on Thanksgiving Day. So that raised suspicion that there might be some sort of hoax going on here.
Mm-hmm.
But she has told the public that it was two Hispanic women, and they wore masks, and they had a revolver and SUV. I feel that's not the truth. I still feel that maybe, I mean, in the condition she was apparently found, nobody talked about her being sexually molested or abused, which maybe they kept out, or maybe they fabricated this whole thing to see if they could flush out who really did this to her. Well, what's interesting about that is then I read yesterday that there's this ex-FBI or whoever profiler who is saying the same thing I'm saying. He's saying that, no, he believes that she was threatened, and they told her they would let her go, but if she ever said anything about the truth, that they would kill her family and come after her. And then you noticed that before that story yesterday, they had already moved out of their home and moved away quickly. So it's interesting, and so that's the same thing with your dog. I made up a card, and you might be right. You may not find it, but you just never know. We'll see.
Right.
talking about it and stuff, how these things tend to occur. But and I'm still following this sheriff Patini case, and it's something I started working on a few years back to see if I can use this ability to maybe locate missing people, kids, things like that. I figured, what do I got to lose? It's an experiment anyway, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's definitely fascinating. Now, did you recall reading somewhere where she was disfigured in some way, or
yes, and she was. Mm-hmm. And she was branded,
yes,
and beat up, and she was found chained and had a sack over her head. But a lot of people thought she was chained to a sign. Then I saw another story where, no, she was loose, but she had the chains on her, and she was wandering up and down the highway trying to flag people down. And then eventually a woman saw her and pulled over and called the police, and then they found her.
Well, the case is definitely interesting because it leaves a lot of questions to the people who are, you know, following that particular case. First off, I couldn't remember when you said the name. It didn't dawn on me until you mentioned the date that she went missing. And it does leave a lot of questions in my mind to what's going on there. So, and I'm sure you probably agree that there's something a little odd in that case.
Yes, I agree with you. I'm, and I like to put this stuff out to your group and to Solaris's group and stuff like that to see if, you know, maybe collectively we can kind of, come up with, I would love to do some experiments with you guys, with your groups, to see if we can have a group consciousness, to see if we can help find missing people or kind of pinpoint some of these open-end dreams that I have where I don't have a specific date, you know, to see if we can tune in, because all of us have different gifts. I know Surlana is a very vivid dreamer like myself. Mm-hmm. obviously she is. And I've had my last girlfriend was the same way, and her daughter was too. But the thing is, I had to get them to start writing them down and studying them. Now, they weren't having the results I were, but I said, hey, look, I've been doing this a long time, and I'm still learning new things.
They're vivid, they're stupid.
Well, yeah, but some of mine are too. Some of mine, some of mine may appear that way, but that's what I'm talking about, how they're fragmented. You know, it's like I said before, a dream to me, and I think to all of us, but I think in my experience, so I don't want to project that onto anyone else, but in my experience, it's like a compilation of scenes. Say you have the dream weaver, as I call it, which is basically a subconscious mind. I've never stated that I think anything supernatural is going on with this. I think it's something inherently that science will eventually prove that we all possess, and some people, through their DNA or through their genetic predisposition.
Well, I think we've talked about this, and I think you might have mentioned this with Solaris Blue Raven, is it's kind of like a hive mind kind of thing.
Yes. Well, yeah, and so, you know, some of us, just like I said, in order to do this, and again, this is just in theory. This isn't, you know, anything proven in my own theory of thinking about this. When you talk about the hive mind, of course, you're talking about, do you know who Rupert Sheldrake is?
That sounds familiar.
Yeah, once again, it's probably going to be one of those, go ahead and tell us, and then I'll say yes.
Well, that's okay. I always like to ask. I do the same thing with you guys and Solaris before. I like to know if people know what I'm talking about first, then I can go into it. And if you do, then that's okay. If you don't, that's okay, too, but I always like to ask. But he had this thing called morphic resonance that he wrote about,
okay,
which is basically another way to say the hive mind in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a study done by Japanese scientists that he came across and wrote about. Everybody thinks he wrote about the 100th monkey effect, but he actually didn't. He writes about morphic resonance. So I want to clear that up, because a lot of people always say, well, the 100th monkey, that was developed by Rupert Sheldrake. It was not. It was a group of Japanese scientists. I don't have their exact name. And the experiment started with an island in 1952 out somewhere out in the South Pacific, I believe, or somewhere around there. I'm trying to condense these things, so not to drag it out. But basically, in a nutshell, they started studying the monkey populations. And they started noticing that one monkey started washing its food, something they had not noticed before, and then suddenly all the monkeys on the island within, like, almost immediately, within hours to its days, all started washing their food. And not only that, but they had islands where other scientists were that were reporting suddenly the same thing was going on. So that makes you kind of think about the hive mind, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I saw that too, where some country where this guy was washing his clothes in the pond or the river. He was on a little dock and just scrubbing his clothes, and this orangutan just saw him doing it, and he's like, hey, give me some clothes. I want to wash some clothes too. So he just started doing it just because, I guess, I don't know if he thinks that's what he should be doing, but that's an orangutan mimicking a human's behavior.
Well, you know what's interesting, and we can chat about this for a brief moment since we're talking about the hive mind. I saw an article today. I started to forward it to you, and I said, no, we'll just talk about it tonight. And it's a study that is online now. It's from the University of Warwick in the United Kingdom. And it's a research project that a number of psychologists put on. And here's what's fascinating, because this kind of backs up a little bit of what Solaris Blue Raven talks about with the mind control issue. Mm-hmm. And the study is done that half of the people remember events that never happened.
Yes.
And they took 400 people and basically implanted memories in them that never occurred. They developed false memories. It's a pretty interesting article, and it was on the CBS site today, and it's basically called Study Half of People Remember Events That Never Happened. Now, I know the last time I was on your show, I think it was Mr. Dino that called in and talked about the Mandela effect, mm-hmm. I believe he did last time.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Can you believe I remember that from 6 months ago?
And he's listening now. He's in our chat now.
What's funny is I'm never surprised with the information you
retain.
Well, yeah. I watched Jeopardy a lot to train my mind and try to keep my mind active as I can. But sometimes this week I was having some, I think because I do what you do, Spaceboy. I have a tendency. I joined Amazon Prime for the 30-day special to see how I would like it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I figured I would cram as much as I could. And I've been binge-watching. I've already watched 10 movies on there and a couple of the series. I think it's been affecting my memory a little bit.
It's very easy to go down that binge-watch kind of thing.
Yeah. But anyway, this is a very interesting study, and again, it may support somewhat of the hive mind. It talks about how we can, and this is why you got to guard yourself indirectly. I've mentioned this to a friend of mine I was meeting with this week. In the DNA, it's the same way that people like Hollywood builds up a movie. Now, think about Rogue One that's opening next Friday, I believe, mm-hmm. correct?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. How can I not think about it?
yeah. I think the whole world knows about that one, even more so than the Star Wars film that was released last year. I think more people are looking forward to this one.
Because it's something new and different, probably.
Yeah. So they started advertising. Do you remember when they started advertising that?
Oh, well, it was, I guess, immediately, like, within the Force Awakens movie?
Almost a year ago.
Yes.
So, see, that's how this same thing happens with the hive mind. You get people and you start doing this build-up. I've even noticed, I started doing this study on watching how I wrote this down, and Nicolas Cage is supposed to star in a movie with this other actress. And what's so interesting is even before they were in this movie, they started releasing little news clips and bits about both of these actors, and I started noticing how all of a sudden it coincided with them being announced and they're going to be in this film together. And I said, this is how it works. And this is the invisible stuff, the subliminal stuff that is going on all around us. Did you get a chance to see the movie Frequencies by chance?
We're so busy. It's still on our to-do list.
Our to-do list, yeah.
Yeah, that's okay. Well, that's okay. When you get a chance, it's a delightful film. And it's an indie project, but I think you two will like it. And Solana, the reason I think you'll like it, because it takes place in England. And it brings up a lot of literature.
He knows me. He knows you.
Yeah. And it's really, in a nutshell, a love story, but I don't want to mislead people. It's very interesting because from the standpoint of, and I've looked at this for many years, and I've heard Solaris talk about this on her show as well, about frequencies. And you guys, I think you did as well. Didn't you have a program?
Yeah, a while back.
Yeah.
Now, I look at it a little differently than maybe the hertz that everybody's talking about. I sort of you know, through my life, I've seen how that maybe we all go through these frequency changes from time to time within our inner being. And sometimes our frequency level is high and sometimes it's low. And this is what may bring people together are these like frequencies. And then suddenly when the frequencies change, it seems like people sort of drift apart. You know, it's just like through your life when you've had these great friendships or relationships, and then suddenly you ask yourself one day, what happened to them? Where did they go? And stuff like that. But that's something we can talk about in another show after you guys maybe watch the movie, that particular movie.
Sure.
So I have something here. I hope you don't mind me reading these things to you.
That's fine.
Well, before you do, let's go ahead and take our top of the hour break, and then we can get into that. So you're listening to Spaceboy Universe. Our guest tonight is Patrick Sporer, a.k.a. the Precog, and we'll be right back after this. You're listening to the Spaceboy Universe show with Spaceboy and Surlana on the SBU network. And you can find the SBU network at sbunetwork.com. Our guest tonight is Patrick Sporer. And Patrick, pick it up from there.
Yes, you know, when we were off camera there, you were talking about that would be just as interesting to hear what we were talking about off camera. Yeah. But we were talking about Surlana's dream life, very much like mine. And then Spaceboy, I had sent them a premonition type of, actually it was sort of a joke, but you know, I've had these things even when I'm joking, then it'll trigger things in people. And you were talking about the praying mantis, that I said, be leery of the praying mantis dream when you have it. But what you were talking about, there's a movie, I don't know if you've seen it, Spaceboy. I know you're like me, you love these old sci-fi movies. Mm-hmm. And it was called 5 Million Years to Earth. Have you seen that?
I have seen that.
And
that's funny because it just, I don't know why, all of a sudden, since we always bring up Solaris Blue Raven, kind of like her book that she has out is called A Million Miles to Midnight. So that little parallel kind of there.
Sure, but when you remember, you were talking about that you thought these other, you were talking about the Minions and what these other things might be.
Well, let me backtrack real quick so that our audience knows, since we were at break. Patrick, you sent a Solaris, too many S's now, Surlana an email about a dream of possibly a mantis, and beware of what the mantis says. Now, before you sent that email to her,
they told me not to punch in the face.
Yeah. So, and I, as I've described to you, that I personally have visions that when I close my eyes and I just look into the ether, I see things. It doesn't happen. You know, there was a dry spot a while back, but now I've kind of trickled stuff comes to me. And more recently, before you sent that email to her, I had had the visions of a mantis head in my mind, or the visions that I was seeing. And then, of course, not too far after that, after you sent the email to her, and then I saw this posting on Facebook of this half mantis, half wasp looking thing. And I thought that was really bizarre. And then, I'm going to kill myself with trying to do these S's.
You could say my wife here.
Hey, my wife here, Space Girl, was having a conversation with me about could these the mantis insects be like a drone force or to send ahead or to kind of like scope us out without actually giving us a feeling of being invaded or something to that effect. And so at that point, take it over, Patrick.
Well, okay. What's interesting about this was actually two things. Because I triggered in you, that's how the repetition phenomenon works for me. I'll see something and it suddenly will, I can feel it resonating in my solar plexus, you might say, sort of like what they said Edgar Casey had occurred to him. Mm-hmm. And I'll jot it down, and not long after that, it'll start repeating, and apparently that's what's happened in your case. But what you made me think of was 5 Million Years to Earth. If anybody's ever seen it out there, if you haven't, you should check it out, because it's so bizarre that we're talking about this, because if you remember that movie, they found that space capsule underneath the subway station.
Yes, yes.
And they were having all this poltergeist activity, and it turned out that it was connected to these dead alien praying mantis-looking insect beings.
And this was British. It was a British show too.
Yeah, it was in the 60s, yes. Way ahead of its time. Yeah, and it was originally called quartermass something. It was, it was supposed to be like a this guy who is an investigator, mm-hmm. and a scientist, but they called it 5 Million Years to Earth. And it's interesting that you're talking about that, because that's very similar to what this film could be about. And it is an interesting aspect to think about, that insects could be, in all reality, some sort of, reporting back information with their frequencies, that we're just unaware of it.
It's not bad enough they're creepy and disturbing and a pestilence. Now they got to be spies. It's just great.
Yeah, they could be. They could be. You mentioned on your show last week that there was somebody who was less than friendly. Or said something.
Yes, we had a person who was not playing ball with the other space cadets and
playing nice,
and yes.
Well, I found a quote this week. I'll tell you who said it after I read it, and it goes like this: it says, "The history of science shows that theories are perishable. With every new truth that is revealed, we get a better understanding of nature, and our conception and views are then modified. That was said by Nikola Tesla. So, you know, this is the thing that when you do a show like this and you have guests on that have these unique experiences, and, you know, there are a number of these type of shows on, and you and Solaris have two of the better ones, I feel, where you get in depth with your host and you allow them to talk about things. But there are some people out there that their minds are so closed. And it's why I stay pretty isolated in my life now. You know, I have my one friend that I meet with who's interested. He says the same thing to me. He says, well, I really don't have anybody to talk to about this stuff. So it's nice that you guys provide an outlet for people like myself and others to be free-minded and without judgment. Well, you know, it doesn't mean that you necessarily agree with every single thing that everybody says. But the nice thing about it is you don't sit there and criticize or try to put anybody down for it. So,
well, you know, it's interesting you bring that up, is because it is something that we value here at Spaceboy Universe, is that we feel very strongly to silence a group or whatever to that effect. It just puts us into a narrow category, which, you know, puts us just chasing our tail. So we never want to silence anybody that wants to speak on a particular topic, because Surlana and myself have always, yeah, I know she's laughing at me over this. It feel like, you know, we want to hear what people have to say. We may not agree with you, but let's be civil. Let's have a conversation. You know, we want to hear what you have to say. It may be off the deep end. When we finish our conversation, we both learn something new about each other. And at least we can agree on some common ground and be good friends. I mean, I'd rather be somebody's friend than to have somebody that's going to spat at me with nonsense and say that the earth is flat or, you know, that kind of backward science mentality kind of level where, you know, science back in the old times, you know, either you concurred with what science had to say or you were a heretic. And, you know, that's not what we preach here. We appreciate everybody that comes on. We appreciate everybody's opinion. But at the same time, you know, there's a certain level of, you know, vulgarity that we will not tolerate here. But, you know, people say swear words, and sometimes they say it in jest. And depending on how it's said, you know, it can go over like, okay, I'm not offended to that. But then there is a time when you have certain people that will get vulgar and in a nasty way, and that's not what I want for this show. And what we strive for is acceptance for all. And there you go.
Yeah, I agree. You know, when I first opened my gym, and it, of course it was a bodybuilding gym, and that was an interesting synchronicity story. I had no plan to do that with my life. It sort of just dropped in my lap, even though I was a bodybuilder. Mm-hmm. One thing I wanted to do is, even being a bodybuilder and before I was a bodybuilder, I can remember that gym, because of the way it was, could be intimidating to people. So I had a sign on the front door that said, you know, when you step in these doors, you need to leave your ego, profession, arrogance, and everything outside, because everybody's going to be the same in here. And everybody really liked that sign. And when they came in, because, I mean, I had people from all walks of life. I mean, I had, you know, you had lawyers and doctors that would come in there because they liked the hardcore training. And then you had mill workers and you had dock workers. But inside, when they got inside that gym, there was such a cohesive kindness and respect for one another. And you know what that has to do with? That has to do with who's setting the bar. And you set the bar for your show, and Solana do. That's embracing people. And that's the same thing I did in my business and why it was successful for so many years when all these other big health clubs were closing around. You know, we don't need to, we need to encourage people. We need to encourage people to be a little more free-minded and not so, when they want to just decide to close it all down and make people feel like, oh, well, they're crazy or things like that. You know, when you're doing something like this, as you know, Spaceboy, being an entertainer yourself with your music, and as I was for many years, you do have to develop a thick skin, because every once in a while, you're going to run into people who, by their nature, they're just acidic, and that's just who they are in their DNA. And probably they're not that way just to you or me. They're that way probably to everybody throughout their life.
Mm-hmm.
So, but anyway, so we've covered a couple of different unique things here. Surlana, you have anything to add?
No, I'm more fascinated about your term you coined, the coincidence repetition phenomenon, and I know I sent you an email about something I had seen, and I've already forgotten what it was, but just let you know that...
Some numbers.
Yeah, some numbers, just to let you know that I actually noticed something, and maybe it came to nothing, but just to let you know that I have experienced it, and I don't know that meant anything, but it was kind of cool. So I'm more aware of that type of thing now.
Yeah, that's all. That's all I try to do is raise awareness. You sent me the digits 4, 11, 18, and 25. You sent those to me on December 3rd.
I'm going to tell you everything I want to remember, Patrick. Then I'm just going to send you an email.
Well, I take to heart when people send me things. I don't just say ignore it. You know, it's just like on my private list of people. You know, there's a lot of people now. They're starting to share the repetition phenomena than it is the dreams, because a lot of people don't dream like you and I do, not with that kind of consistency and clarity. But they do, they're starting to notice these things when they start repeat, and they said, hey, I would have never ever thought to notice that before. Now, before they probably thought I was a little off my rocker.
It's kind of fun in a way.
Yes. Yeah, sure. Well, you know, what's interesting about that, Surlana, I'm sure glad you brought that up, because I made a post, and I don't know if you, did I send you the one on Eureka?
Yes, I read that today. Twice.
Now, I know, of course, this is an experiment, but anybody that looked at that, and remember, that was only like 3 days before that earthquake hit offshore, right in the same area. When I saw the map, in fact, I thought I was dreaming. When I saw the news, I went, wait a minute, is this a dream? Wait a minute, wake me up here. I just wrote that down about 3 days ago, and it didn't occur from a dream. It occurred in that strange, bizarre way where these things start repeating, much like they did with Richard Dreyfuss in the great film Close Encounters of the Third Kind, when all the contactees were seeing the Devil's Tower. Remember, they were all seeing images and writing it down and everything else, and it eventually led them to the outcome, which was they were getting a private invitation from the aliens, which should bring us to talk about Arrival.
He is a master of segues.
So you can have your own show. Now, we saw Arrival, it was 2-3 weeks back, but it was, we had an opportunity, so we'd go see it, even though we knew it was going to be a little soon, but we left the theater, and I was thinking, wait a minute, we were like, okay, we had questions.
We left the theater, and you looked like you'd been hit by a truck, and
by the time I got to the car, I was like, oh, okay, now I get it. Okay.
And the only other movie that...
I had to think about it for a while.
Did that to me, well, I guess a different way was... when I saw AI, everybody that left the movie theater out of that movie was quiet. And I've never experienced... the only other movie that I experienced like that was Seven. But Arrival, we left, and you were quiet. We were kind of like... I don't know if it was because we were both processing the movie, but indeed the movie is not like a Disney Marvel movie, or it's not action packed.
It wasn't about destruction. Of course, that was a theme of because us knuckle dragon apes are always ready to fire at something we don't get. Yeah. So, but that was not the sole focus. It was more about communication and trying to figure something out, and the storytelling of it was interesting. It's I'm not going to say it's reminiscent of, let me get his name right, because I call him something else derogatory, M. Night Shyamalan. Actually, I think it was better than him, but it was something like, you think you know what's going on, and then it turns out no. It's an interesting way to tell a story from that direction.
Yes, I agree with you 100%. And it's going to be interesting. The Golden Globes nominations come out on Tuesday, I think. And it's going to be interesting to see if Arrival gets some good nods. You know, and I want to talk about this some more, but I saw in your chat somebody named Catalina. Catalina, is she a regular, space cadet?
Yeah.
I don't know if she considers herself a space cadet, but she's a regular listener.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she mentioned Colin Farrell's name. Did she say that a little while ago? Did I miss that? Did I get that correct? Or was it Dennis? Somebody said Colin Farrell on there.
I must have missed that. I was just so engrossed.
See, he's always watching.
Yeah, I see.
Yeah. Anyway, I just wanted to verify that I said something. Yeah. But the listen. When I come to your show, I want to try to cover these things and make sure I pay attention to your audience. You know what they're saying there. Yes, she did. Okay, there it is right there. Yeah, the reason I wanted to bring that up is there's a very interesting film coming out where he plays a sidekick, but he plays a serial killing psychic. Opposite Anthony Hopkins, who is also a psychic, and it's S-O-L-A-C-E. Surlana, how do you say that? Is it Solace or Solas?
Say it again.
S-O-L-A-C-E.
S-O-L-A-C-E. Solace?
Well, maybe that, too. But whatever, it is I've seen the previews, and I've been waiting for it for a year and a half because they've gone back and forth. There was a financing issue, and there was a distribution issue, and it's supposed to be released this December or this month, and it looks incredible. I mean, Jeffrey Dean Morgan is in it. I forget who the female actress is. She's well known. I know that. I can't think of the name. It may come to mind.
That rings a bell. Maybe I saw something about it in passing, this movie.
Yeah, I don't know if I sent you guys the trailer on it a while back.
I'll look for it. I'll write it down.
But I shared it with a lot of people, and not a lot of people responded to it, but I felt that your audience, and of course Solaris' audience, and those are the type of people who love these kind of films.
Psychic serial killer. So he's got some kind of edge through psychic.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and Anthony Hopkins is a retired, I think, an FBI profiler who they bring out of retirement to try to track him down.
You're going
to
love this. Because,
what, where does Anthony Hopkins have time for all this?
When an FBI agent, Joe and Merriweather, who's played by Jeffrey Dean Morgan, you know who that is? He's Negan on The Walking Dead. Is unable to solve a series of homicides. He decides to enlist the help of a former colleague, Dr. John Clancy, played by Anthony Hopkins. And it goes on here, but yeah, it's got the poster. It's got the Anthony Hopkins on it.
Well, Hopkins is busy.
And then part of him is kind of like replaced with Jeffrey Dean Morgan. I'm intrigued by this.
Yes, yes. Another movie you'll like, Spaceboy, it's new to Netflix. It's called Spectral.
Yes, Spectral. It's on my list of things to do, the binge watch. It's one of those movies.
I watched it last night.
Okay, yeah, see, it's one of those things where Solana can watch me while I'm in my chair, while I watch movies, and she knows, okay, thank God he doesn't have me doing something.
Yes, I love it when he's busy.
This is supernatural stuff. It's really good, but it's interesting because I could easily see that, I could easily see something like this not necessarily happening in that way, but I don't want to tell you anything because the ending is sort of a surprise.
Yeah, well, don't tell me on that one.
It's a quick 90-minute movie. It's got a lot of action in it, trust me, but it's got a good story, too. It's got a very interesting story. Go ahead, Serlana.
I'm sorry about that. Well, what was your overall impressions about Arrival as far as it not being typical alien movie?
I'm going to answer that. I just wanted to answer Dino on your chat.
Sure,
no, I have never done remote viewing, Dino. I have been asked to. There's an actual organization in the United States that caters to. They say precogs, but they do more remote viewing. And what I do is is a little different than remote viewing, but similar in a way. I just don't know that I could devote as much time to both of these things. And as intriguing as remote viewing is, I'm not really sure that it's a fit for me. I wouldn't consider myself a remote viewer. But back to Arrival. Do we have time to chat before the next break?
We've got about at least 5 minutes here.
Well, number one is, before we go there, I saw AI. And when I saw AI, I walked out of the theater so depressed about life. That movie bothered me very, very bad.
I agree with you on this one.
And the problem was, I said, I'm never going to watch this movie again like I did The Exorcist, and I've never watched The Exorcist again. I can't watch that movie twice. But I made the mistake. It was just one of those nights, I'm channel surfing, I go, oh, there's AI. I'll give it another chance. Same thing. After it was over, I hit that depressed state again, and I went, oh, no, oh, geez. I said, I mean, it's just one of those films. I mean, it was a Stanley Kubrick film is what drew me to it, not just Spielberg,
right.
Although Spielberg
right.
directed it. Fascinating in many ways, but so, I mean, oof, you know, the outcome, and it's kind of like that sci-fi, remember the sci-fi series they had on called, it was by Arthur C. Clarke. What was the name of it?
The Martian Chronicles?
Like three-part.
Or
No, it was like a three-parter. It was like back in January, February.
Childhood's End?
Oh, well, no, it was like really, oh gosh, I can't believe it. I can't remember the title of it. But anyway, it'll come to me. But anyway, that was another depressing. I can't ever watch that again either. You know, that's one of those that I said, oh God. Because all these are really, the thing is, the sad part about it with AI, which was made 15 years ago or 16 years ago,
mm-hmm.
was the fact that what we're experiencing right now with artificial intelligence is pretty scary.
Right.
Because and after watching Westworld, and you guys, you've only watched six episodes, trust me, the final episode is, I mean, are you aware of the final episode? Or
I've kept myself in the blank on this one. And
yeah, well, let's not discuss Westworld then, since you haven't seen it, because anyway, all I can tell you is it is so well done. It is nothing like the original 1973 movie, which was mm-hmm. a good movie for its day.
Oh, yeah.
But it shows you how Michael Crichton has influenced the world. I mean, between Jurassic Park and between Westworld, and I'm sure his vision was probably more like this actual J.J. Abrams and Christopher Nolan and all these great people that are behind all this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Westworld is a top notch. In fact, it's stealing thunder from the, you know, our other great show, The Walking Dead, which has lost a lot of viewers this season. And they think it might be Westworld is stealing them because Walking Dead is lost. They still are. Childhood's End, that's the name of it. Fran just mentioned it.
I just
it
said
on,
that.
Oh, I didn't hear you. I didn't hear you, so I
you go, no, that's not
yes.
it.
Childhood's End. I didn't hear you. I apologize. I apologize.
Smack you.
For that. You were correct. You were correct. But, yeah, Childhood's End, that was another one of those. To me, I just said to myself, yeah, I can't watch that one again either. But Arrival, such a cerebral science fiction, the kind I really like. And they tried to do a similar movie with George Clooney a long time ago. It was about 15 years ago, similar in a way to this, and it didn't work at all. Our people just didn't gravitate towards it. But this one is all about foreshadowing and dreams and how and Surlana is correct, how the story, you have to really watch it carefully because, and this is one that I will watch again and probably more than once because of how well done it is. It's like a piece of art. And didn't you love the soundtrack to it?
Oh, yeah.
Westworld? You're talking about what soundtrack to Westworld?
Or Arrival.
Arrival.
To Arrival.
I can't recall.
The meat and potatoes of that movie is great because, you know, we've been so bombarded with such action flick films and this and that, and explosions, to actually go into a movie where, you know, in my mind, you know, it is like reading a book, a good book. And it wasn't so in your face. And
Because it was a story first.
Yeah, and the movie's subtle, you know, and it was easy to digest and left me at the end of like, okay, that was interesting. I enjoyed that. That was refreshing. In fact, it reminds me of the old days when I worked at Blockbuster Video, and I used to have to watch everything to recommend things to people. And to come across a movie like Arrival was always great because, you know, having to digest Well, I just watched Jane Fonda's workout video, so if I had to recommend that to somebody, I can't. But, I mean, Arrival was just...
Poor thing.
Yeah, I know. I had to watch all that stuff. It was it was terrible. Terrible, man. And so, but, you know, Arrival, great movie, and the soundtrack was very subtle. And but when you talk about, I know I hate to switch gears on this one, but Westworld's soundtrack has been... A gem to itself.
Yeah, a lot of original orchestral scores, but we were watching, I must have been the first or second one, and, you know, it takes place supposedly in the Old West, and they have a player piano in the saloon, and I just happened to catch it. I said, is that Black Hole Sun on the player piano? And sure enough, it was. And, of course, they had a long orchestral version of Paint It Black. And then they've got an Amy Winehouse Back to Black or Back in Black or something. Like, what is the theme of all these songs that have the word black in the title? I haven't figured that out yet.
Well, that's interesting. See, everybody gets something. It's just like dreams, Surlana. Everybody gets something different. And that's what makes sharing. You know, I've always said you guys should do a show just on movies and talking about interacting with that because it fascinates people. And there's so millions of people out there that love listening to this. And of course, if you logged me and Spaceboy in a room, we would probably grow beards talking about movies and having to feed us through the door, the history of TV and movies. But
I'll be next door reading the books.
Oh, of course you will. That's like my friend George. When I meet with him, he always has a book there. He's reading it before I get there, or, you know, or when we take a break. He loves books. My sister's the same way. My older sister, she loves reading books. But back to Arrival. Arrival, again, foreshadows, and the thing that I of course, my aspect of watching, now, you got to remember, I went, it was a special preview, you know, like they do on Thursday nights, sometimes they'll release a film Thursday, and I took a chance, I said, oh gosh, I hope it's not packed, because it was getting such great P&A, you know, advertising all over the place, so I said, and this is the first time I've been in a theater in 18 months, because I have a nice setup at home, and I really like watching it, because I can play stuff back and watch it carefully, and there's no distractions. But when I went that night, there was maybe 20, 25 people in there, and I remember everybody was so glued to that film. And after it was over, I saw people crying, and I saw other people just scratching their head. I saw people just sitting there in their seats like they were stunned. It really affected people. And for me, of course, I think about these things for days, you know, and sitting there, okay, they did this and did that. But the heptapods were foreshadowed, if you remember, by the clay object.
Right.
You remember that? Now, her daughter, apparently, Hannah, right? Was that her daughter's name?
It's a palindrome.
Had made that. But the truth of the matter was here's the big question. Was Amy Adams Banks, the linguist, was she dreaming all of this and getting all this information via a dream like you and I do, right? And it was going to play out in a different way because basically and Spaceboy, I like your take on this. This is a movie that gives humanity hope. Mm-hmm. This is a movie that gave us a good feeling about possible interaction with the future of ETs, and that maybe they have had a hand in our existence, and maybe just like Solana, me, other dreamers, vivid dreamers, just like you with your music. They're communicating to us in these different mediums. Like I said, the burning bush comes in many forms, in many different mediums. Maybe the whole symbolism from the Bible. And I'm not a religious guy, but you guys know the story what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm. Well, Patrick, before you go any further, we're already at the bottom of the hour. Let's go ahead and take the bottom of the hour break. And I still want to continue some of this discussion that we're having on the movie Arrival because...
Well, people are like, don't spoil it. I haven't seen it. I'm like, no, you've had plenty of time.
But let's talk...
Just jot down our stopping place there so we can carry on.
Yeah.
Definitely. So you're listening to Spaceboy Universe on the SBUnetwork.com, and we will be right back after this musical interlude. We'll be right back. So you're listening to SpaceboyUniverse.com on the SBUNetwork.com. And tonight's special guest is Patrick Sporer. And Surlana and I have been talking to Patrick about the Arrival movie. And some of you haven't seen the movie, and shame on you. It's a good movie. You should go check it out and see it, because it's definitely worth going to see. Wouldn't you agree, Surlana?
Well, yeah. Now, I won't spoil it. Don't worry. But when we left the theater, like I said, I think about it. And then I thought I knew, okay, so this is what happened. But now listening to Patrick, now I'm wondering if I'm incorrect. Not that it matters, but I thought I had the plot down.
Well, you again, this is one of those films. That's just what's so good about it, because it's again, your perception of what you were experiencing with it and what I took away from it. We might both be right. Partially right.
Saying maybe she's getting this information in dreams, and then I took the clues from the fact, and I don't think this will give anything away, that she said at the beginning, I thought this is where your story began, and then there's a point where she says, who is this child? And I was like, how does she not know? I'm like, that's when I was walking out there, like, oh. And then the heptapod says, you see the future too. And I'm like, oh, okay, I got it. So
exactly. And not only that, but you may remember the Jeremy Renner saying, are they communicating to you in your dreams?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Remember that line of dialogue? And he turned out to be the husband.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and he was the physicist, and so it was a sort of a synchronicity, that sort of the ETs, for lack of a better word, of the heptapods. Am I saying that correctly?
Mm-hmm.
And they sort of brought this whole scenario together by their arrival. That's what I got from it. But at the same time, the heptapods were trying to bring about world peace, because if you remember, she saw in a dream where she spoke to the Chinese,
mm-hmm.
correct?
Mm-hmm.
Was he the president, or was he in charge?
No, he's in charge of the military.
Yeah, in charge of the military.
Right, and she had the one clue from a dream, and she was having flashbacks as all this stuff was playing out in real time. She was starting to have these flashbacks on how to subvert this potential nuclear destruction of the world by trying to eliminate, obviously it wasn't going to work. And also the heptapods, if you remember, protected Amy Adams and Jeremy Renner when the soldiers tried to bomb the first, the pod,
mm-hmm.
the ship.
Mm-hmm.
You recall that?
Yeah.
Yes.
And they forced them out and prevented and then there was something about the other. I hope we're not spoiling it for your audience. I'm trying to sort of raise their curiosity so they'll go see it without actually telling them what occurs too much. So, you want to? Does your chat mind if we discuss this movie for?
Well, let's take a quick poll here. We can really, since you're watching too. Is spoilers going to be too much for you, the space cadets that are listening?
You know,
tonight is your chance to chime in real time and say that yes, this is too much spoilies. Sweetie.
We can move on to something else. I don't want to ruin.
It's well, okay, it's getting really the whole movie here. So,
well, I mean, it is a jam-packed night. So we talked a little bit about it and kind of whet the appetite of the space cadets to go check this movie out.
I also enjoy when Patrick talks about synchronicity.
Well, again, the one last thing to say about Arrival and why.
Sure.
Is that the reason you guys are talking about it and why we're discussing it tonight is not so much to spoil the movie, but to talk about how it seems to appear that it works similar to how I experience life in dream and how a lot of us do when we get foreshadowing of events. So we'll leave it at that, and we don't want to ruin it for anybody else. I hope it does get a nomination. Mm-hmm. I hope that it. I don't know if it'll win, but
so this is the part where I'm going to ask. Surlana, how many rockets would you give or how many, what is it, what were the aliens called again?
I would give it six legs out of eight heptapods or something like that.
There you go. Must go see. So people should check out this movie, and you will not be disappointed. Would you agree, Patrick?
Spatrick?
I'm combining names.
Again, if you like a cerebral thinking person's movie that is nothing like Independence Day or the Alien movies, it's a really thought-provoking film, then you definitely will love this movie. And the way that it's shot, it's just the way, and of course Spaceboy, because he's a music artist, he'll tell you that the soundtrack alone, it puts you in a state, you know, when you're watching this film. It's really well done.
It is.
I would give it two thumbs up.
Hey,
yeah, very straightforward.
Yeah, see, you know, our system is really convoluted, but at the end, you really basically get an understanding that we enjoyed the movie, and you should definitely go see it. We saw that movie over Doctor Strange, which I'm still dying to go see, but I still enjoyed Arrival immensely.
Yeah, I haven't seen Doctor Strange yet either. I'm trying to debate on whether I want to go to the theater and see that.
Or rent it.
The only other science fiction movie that I might go to the theater to see is Passengers.
Oh, yes. Yeah. That looks really good. Jennifer Lawrence and Chris Pratt. Yes.
Yeah. It's coincidental that two hot people just happen to wake up, isn't it? I love the way Hollywood does, you know.
Anyway, to ask you about... you know, you have dreams and you talk about, you know, sometimes they foreshadow events, but do you not think that when you said something about, I was going to have this dream about a mantis, that's more of a self-fulfilling prophecy because you put the idea in my head, now it's going to happen, even though it hasn't happened yet? Or do you not think that's valid?
Well, again, you know, that's interesting that you say that, because that's why I brought the article up about how it's obviously being proven that we can, that somebody can supplant false memories in people, make them have memories of things that never even occurred to them. So it's very possible. And of course, my training in hypnosis would suggest that there is a power of suggestion. And it is a possibility that I did trigger something and he started seeing it. But still, what if there, I mean, you know, it's just like with these things that I have occur. What makes me write the first one down? What makes me pay attention to it? And then suddenly there's a stream of these things that will just start. It's like the minute I pay attention to it, suddenly it just takes on a life of its own. And I've seen this with the lotto. I've won money on the lotto with this. As a matter of fact, I'm glad you said that. I haven't been playing the lotto in a while because I'm studying for doing something different. But I made a post about the four digits 2222 repeating. Did you happen to read that one, Surlana?
I think I might have missed that one.
Well, that's okay. That's okay. I won't drag this out because if people want to go to the blog, look, the best thing to do, I can tell everybody, like I was announcing on Solaris' show, without me having to read all these and be boring and all that stuff, it's just easier if you go to the blog. I post these things daily. Since I was on your show in June, as I was telling Solaris, I was on her show in June right after yours, I have had my audience quadruple. I don't know where they're coming from, but they're, I mean, all over the world, you know, unless it's somebody has a hoax and they're feeding me these things, which I guess is always the possibility, right, out there today. You don't ever know. But the, so I know a lot of people, and these are, I can see the consistency, and it's just like when I advertise being on either of their shows. I mean, like, there was one day there was like 6,000 at one moment. And I said, this is what I need to post this right now. And I've learned a lot about blogging, and there's a lot of little tricks to it on when you post that as opposed to another time. Because I made a post with Angela Bassett. Remind me to get back to the 2222 story still. But I made a post that I had a dream about Angela Bassett and what's the Big Bang Theory? Do you guys watch that?
No. Yeah.
Who's one of the actors there?
Well, you've got gosh, you've got a lot of them. Jim Carson.
Yeah, he was in The Dream, and then the late George Kennedy was in The Dream, and I cannot figure out for the life of me why that particular post got so many hits. I mean, it got a phenomenal amount of hits, and I still can't figure out why, because Angela Bassett had an immediate Lotto hit, and when I posted Angela Bassett, it didn't come anywhere near the result hits that I saw with that original post, and the same thing with Jim Parsons. I had a hit on him 2 days right after The Dream, and so I can't figure out what I did on that one, and that's what I do, is I go back and study these particular posts that seem to have these, you know, some of them will just draw huge hits, and other ones still do well, but not like those initially, and I haven't quite figured out what I said in there or what triggered it. That even goes back to what you were talking about, Solana, about the suggestion, the power of suggestion. And I do experiment. I did a lot of studying on subliminal advertising many years ago. When you're in business, you try to think of all these different ways to advertise your business. Fortunately for me, word of mouth was always my best medium. But of course, I promoted bodybuilding shows and of course the Magic Mike shows on a regular basis for close to 15 years. And I learned little tricks that you could say about a group or how you would, you know, advertise this versus this. And again, there's just these little key words sometimes, just these little key things that will seem to trigger things in people's minds. And Hollywood and the music world know how to use these type of things to get people to go see films and trigger it. But with this 2222, what happened back in, it's 2012, I believe. It was January 10th, 2012. 2 weeks prior to that, I started seeing 2222 everywhere. And I mean, it's all posted on the blog. You can look it up. You can just put in 2222 and you can see the result of that. I won a lot of money because of that. But the, and that wasn't from a dream. That was from this repetition phenomena, which I've condensed from coincidence repetition phenomena. I just said, well, we'll just call it repetition phenomena. Be a good title for a book, wouldn't it? Repetition phenomena, do you think?
Oh, yeah.
Maybe. A book I'll probably never write. But the, well, maybe somebody will write it for me or something, or I'll co-write it with somebody or have a ghostwriter or something. But anyway, so it was recurring, and then I remember the last time I saw it. Here's what was so interesting about that. I was pulling in to get gas at a convenience store, and when I pulled up, there was a moving truck in front of me, and the last four digits of the phone number, believe it or not, were 2222. So I said, oh, this is a sign. So I went in and got the lotto card, filled it out, came in. I made sure I was too late to play for the evening, so I said, well, I'll play for midday tomorrow, and it hit the very next day. And I had a really nice jackpot, that's all I can tell you.
Okay. But
well, I mean, each one of those, one ticket is $5,000. Mm-hmm. So if you buy, and that only costs $1. So it does work. And I'm just giving you one example. Now 2222 is repeating again. But I made a discovery that I said, okay, it's not always necessarily lotto, and that's what I always warn everybody about, because I had another guy trying this, and he wasn't having a lot of success. And I said, look, there's more to it. But people get tunnel vision, Surlana. You know, unlike yourself, you're a reader, so you read carefully, right, and you absorb. Mm-hmm. And George, my good friend George, he's the same way. He reads these things verbatim, word for word. My older sister does the same thing. Other people make this mistake of skimming over them or just reading the subject line. And then they say, oh, yeah, that's really cool. And then when I quiz them on it, like I've caught you guys sometimes in the crosshairs there.
Yeah.
Did you read this? Yeah. and then suddenly I realized they really didn't read it. And so they missed out the whole thing. So anyway, I played it multiple times, so you can imagine I was very happy. Now, when I shared that information, this is immediately what people do, and it shows you in this paranormal, supernatural, whatever you want to call it, world, how quick that there's people that say they believe in this stuff But they don't believe it when it happens to somebody they know. You get what I'm saying, right?
Yeah.
It's just like if you suddenly had this great, your music suddenly, somebody came to you, Spaceboy, and you had this door open for you. See, I'm one of those people that would be so thrilled for you because I understand what that means. There's other people, not so much. You'd be surprised, you know, and actually might not even believe that you're even telling the truth. And that's why I'm one of the few people that will tell you, hey, you don't believe me about the little critter I experienced when I was a kid or these experiences, hook me up to a lie detector, and I will be glad, you know, to show you that this stuff really did occur, and it's all true. Now, George, who has watched me do this stuff, and I even showed him just sitting at lunch sometimes, I'd say, George, did you hear that number just then? And he said, you know, I heard it. I heard something, but I didn't hear the clarity of the number. So I'd say, this is the number that was just announced right there. And I'll give him an example of that. In fact, we just did it this past week. And he said, see, you can do this. He said, you have these things happen, and you've proven. I've told other people you do this, and they don't act like they believe me. And some of them are his own kids who are adult kids. And it gets down to the mistake you make in life is when you make things too competitive. Like, oh, he's better than me, or she's better than me, or Surlana dreams better than this person, or Patrick dreams better. It's not a competition. That's why I try to tell everybody. There should be no competition in this metaphysical world about who's better at this or who's better at that. We should be encouraging each other to enhance our abilities. Wouldn't you agree?
Oh, most definitely.
True, but I'll just say it. You don't want my dreams. Trust me, you don't want them.
Well, no, but your dreams are special to you and have your own symbolic meaning. It's like I tell people, I have people send me dreams, and I tell them all the time, I don't interpret dreams. I can help you maybe break down the fragments, or I can tell you what that dream would mean if it was mine, but I can't tell you precisely
right.
Because
you don't know your personal meanings and significances.
Yeah, right. And that's why I'm against all these dream encyclopedias and all that stuff, because of the fact that those, they're meaningless. You can't possibly generalize. It's like Spaceboy seeing, like he and I had this discussion before, you know, he may see a praying mantis and he might think of it as one thing. I might see it and think of it as another thing.
I tell mine strictly for entertainment value, not to try to learn anything.
Well, they are entertaining, but there's probably some pretty interesting information in there. But back to what I was saying on this repetition phenomenon, this is one example. And so George said, I said, George, look, I know, I told him the story, and I said, here's what I want you to do. I let's shoot a video, because he and I have shot some videos in the past, pretty interesting experimental videos, and we did them all in one take, and that's what he couldn't believe. And we shot them with a boom box with the soundtrack. He just wouldn't believe it. He doesn't want me to put them online because he thinks somebody will say we're trying. I said, George, you can put videos on experimentally. You're not making a profit. He said, well, because we used music from Yanni and we used music from somebody else. And so I don't know if I would put them on there or not. But if you saw them, you would see exactly what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And these are all one take type things. It lasted for like some of them 5 minutes and no traffic came by. No airplanes flew over. It was just. And no editing or nothing. It was just like we shot them and that's how it was. But I said, I want you to go with me to Tallahassee to show people that these tickets, this money I won is real. He said, okay. And he went. And he said, well, and I showed him the check that they issued me. It took about 15, 20 minutes, just a long drive over there. You can actually mail those things in too. You don't have to go. But I wanted him to be there as a witness. And I said, now, you see that? Do you think they would issue that with my name if this was a hoax? He said, no. And so there's no sense. I'm not going to waste my time or waste anybody else's time trying to hoax people. For what? I'm not making any money on anybody with the blog anyway, you know, or anything like that. So why would I waste my time even talking about this stuff if I didn't have a lot of passion and heart for it?
Mm-hmm. I just thought it was interesting that you tell me I'm going to have this dream about this. I don't have it, but he picks up on it and has something, and I'm still, like, my subconscious totally did not pick up on that, like, it hasn't happened yet or something, but everything in other insane thing you can think of, I've dreamed about, but it, like, stuck to him for some reason.
Well, and it could have, you know, I'll tell you another story. I had a dream about a friend of mine, and he was very sick. I think I told you, well, actually, let me back up a moment. I called in on one of your shows where I said you were having your anniversary show back, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in September.
And I told you I had picked up on you being sick and you were already ill, and I said it was about 10 days ago, and you said, well, Patrick, that's exactly when it occurred. But I didn't put it down anywhere, and I didn't forewarn you of it. And you said in the future, well, if you do get something like that, send it to you, right? Do you remember that?
Yeah, I remember it.
Yeah. Okay. Is he still there?
I'm still here.
There.
Yeah,
laughing.
I'm laughing to myself. I'm sorry. I guess maybe I need to chuckle a little bit louder.
Yeah. Oh no. So anyway, the thing about that was, I had a dream in early September of a guy. His name is Rocky, a friend of mine, trained at the gym, but I hadn't seen him in a long time. When I retired from the gym business, I sort of just went into isolation and stayed away from the whole bodybuilding scene. I just don't even go into, I don't join gyms. I train at home, all that stuff. I just wanted to totally go another direction. And the problem when I go to a local gym, if there's anybody in there that knows me, there's no way I'm going to get a workout in because you're going to come up and talk and say, hey, can you help me with this? And it's just tough to do. That's why I just don't do it. So anyway, his name is Rocky.
That's and my dad's name. Legit. That's
okay,
his real name.
Well, that's interesting because look at that. So let me just write
spelled
that
a little
down.
Different.
Maybe there's a little hidden message here. But anyway, what happened is I dreamed about him early September. Then 2 weeks later, I have a dream about a friend of mine who committed suicide about 4 years ago. And that was a shocking suicide because this guy had a great life, great wife, great kids, a lot of money, his own business, very nice person. And I met him through bodybuilding years ago and was actually a mentor to him to help him get ready for some of his shows. And when I heard about it, I was just like shocked. But now he shows up in this dream, Surlana, you can relate to this, so vividly. And he walks up to me and I remember we shake hands and he smiles at me. Now that's about a week after the dream of Rocky. Okay, then I have a dream about a guy named RB who used to train at my gym, another guy I mentored who became a personal trainer. And he died in his sleep, and he was only 40 years old. And that's another interesting story because he even told me when he was around in his early 20s that he didn't think he would live to the age of 40, and he died right at 40. So I noticed that when he started showing up in dreams, now anybody can go on the blog and look these up too. These are all real, and I posted all this stuff before these things occur. This isn't like an every once in a while thing. We want to de-stress that. These are, you know, I make daily postings, and I follow up with these things as well. So anyway, I dream of RB, and every time I see RB, 99.9% of the time, somebody that he and I both knew or that he trained or trained at my gym dies within a short period of time. Then I have the second dream of Rocky, and he doesn't look well at all. And I said, oh, there's something wrong. Now, I'm sending these dreams to my private list. All these were posted on the blog, if I recall right. So one of my friends gets back with me and he says, I got to tell you what's going on with Rocky because he read this. Well, he didn't want to tell me in the earlier dreams because he knows this synchronicity that I have with these dreams, these fragments all kind of are links and chain, and then when the incident happens, it all makes sense. So when I had that dream, I didn't find out that Rocky had killed himself until almost 3 weeks later. He had killed himself around the time of the second dream where he didn't look well. Now, what my friend told me, who he didn't want to tell me in the beginning because they were keeping it private, he had stage 4 lung cancer. Now, Solana, you probably remember me mentioning that to Space Boy.
Yeah,
back
then
during the anniversary show.
Yes.
And so he just thought that he wasn't going to live, and he didn't want to live like that. So he took his own life on September 26th, which was only like within 3 or 4 days of the last dream I had of him. So playing it back, and I talked about this with Solaris about how I'm trying to come up with an idea for a show, but I don't know that I'll ever do it, called Cosmic Autopsy, where we take cases like this and we work them backwards like a detective would do, like in the CSI case, and to find out how these dreams are foreshadowing. So I immediately went back. Now, I had the dream of Rocky. Then I had the dream of this guy named Chris who killed himself. Now, you see the through line here? Space Boy, you see the through line on this?
Mm-hmm.
yeah, it's just like a story. So I had the dream, first dream of Rocky. That was a trigger. Pay attention that it could be Lotto or news about him. I had the second dream of Chris, the guy who killed himself, who was also a bodybuilder, by the way. Then I have the dream of RB, who is, I call, the Grim Reaper. Most of the time when he shows up in dreams with, like, clockwork, it's generally, now it can be Lotto every once in a while, and sometimes it's even both. Most of the time I've noticed that when he shows up or his brother shows up, both are dead. Somebody from my gym, or usually that was in my gym, or that one of those guys trained is going to die. Then I hear of Rocky dying shortly after that. So, see, all those things came together like links in chain, and I already knew that somebody was, and I had a feeling it might have been Rocky, but I wasn't 100% until my other friend told me what happened, because he had been communicating with him, and his son had been talking with him because his son had had cancer as well. And, of course, I didn't know all this was going on at the time, and then when he brought me up to speed on it, he said, well, this is what you were picking up on. I said, of course, absolutely. And it was very sad, of course, but at the same time, you can't really judge, you know, suicide is a funny thing, and if any of us in those shoes, there's no telling what we would do. But he was beyond treatment, and he just didn't want to go through it and everything else, so he just ended his own life. And he was like 69 years old. That's considered young in our world today.
Oh, most definitely. So, Patrick, we've kind of passed a little bit at the top of the hour, so let's go ahead and take this top of the hour break. You're listening to Spaceboy Universe on the Spaceboy Universe Network. And we will be back with our guest tonight, Patrick Sporer. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. And you're listening to Spaceboy Universe on the SBU Network. And tonight's special guest, and man, has it blown by quickly, Surlana, is Patrick Sporer. And it's always a treat to have you on, sir. And in fact, right out of the gate, we have our first caller of the evening. It is the man from the Great White North, Ty.
Our favorite Canadian.
How are you, Ty?
Very cold.
I bet with that Arctic blowing through the Great White North up there.
We have, by morning, we have minus 41 wind chills.
Wow.
I can't even conceive of what that's like.
Yeah, I think it's cold here in Florida.
By the way, it's minus 40 Fahrenheit is minus 40 Celsius as well.
Yeah, wow, that's cold, to say the least.
Cold and math? Ugh.
Yeah, everything's frozen.
So what's going on with you tonight, Ty? You have a question or comment?
Yes, I did have a question for Patrick. I had a friend that passed away, a longtime friend, 38 years. He passed away in April. And ever since he's passed away, I've been seeing his birth date in clocks and on the computer. And it's the date is 10-10. His name was Tom. I'm just wondering, does it work backwards?
What do you mean? You're saying that you're seeing 10-10 everywhere, correct?
Yeah. Like, normally it would be like if I see 10-10 and then perhaps he would pass away kind of thing. But since he's passed away, I've been seeing 10-10.
Well, see, now for me, if you ever have gone to the blog and look, I list possibilities when I start doing a post. So I never narrow it down to one thing. I'll say 10-10 recurring could mean, now, I don't know, do you guys have the lotto in Canada?
Yes, we do, yeah.
Okay, do you have a play four game or a pick four game?
Not that I'm aware of, no. We usually just go with the six out of 49 or something like that.
Well, the reason being is, like I just told the 22-22 story, that's a game called Pick 4. It used to be called Play 4, and they switched to Pick 4 here a few months ago. It's the same game. And when I see a 3 or 4-digit number repeating, I generally, 99% of the time, it's usually associated with the lotto, the Florida lotto. So you're 10-10. How long have you been seeing this, Ty?
Since April.
Oh, wow. Been seeing a long time. Hmm. Do you know what he died of?
He was suffering from depression and he committed suicide.
Oh, I see, a similar situation.
Yeah, now, that's kind of...
Yeah. The, now, for me, again, whenever I see, like I said, when I see a number repeating, I'll go and I'll put it down as, like, 10-10. I'll write it at the top of the list, and then I'll start going down that list and saying, what all does this mean to me? From, and of course, you relate it to your friend, which was Tom, you said?
Yes.
Tom. And he suffered from depression. Okay, and then at the same time, I'll say, okay, well, I'll put down the lotto potential. I won't only put lotto potential. I'll say it could come in as a combination on the Florida Lotto Pick 4 as 10-10 or some other combination. That is a very rare number to come in here, by the way, and a lot of times it's sold out. I've noticed things about the lotto, about how people will play their birthdays, and a lot of times you can't even buy these numbers because they're sold out because everybody plays their birthday. Now, I will say that is one thing. Then all of a sudden, I'll look at what came in on 10-10 the last 2 years of this gentleman's birthday, which, I would look, now that it's passed, I would look at 10-10 2016. I would go and look at the archives in wherever it is in Canada or wherever. Is it a province where you live or something?
Yes, I live in Alberta, yes.
Okay, so you live in Alberta. So you, and I don't know if they have a separate, like in the United States, we have all these, we have the Florida Lotto, which is archived strictly for Florida. So I can go on there, and it's really nice. They do a nice job with it. So you can look at that, and you can look back at what hit on 10-10-2016, in 10-10-2015. And usually here in Florida, we have a midday and an evening draw time. So it'll give you a couple different numbers you can look at and say, okay. And this is something you can just study. You don't have to play. I do this all the time. I do it as a study and an experiment. The other thing is, like I said, when people that have passed away in my dreams, now I dream about my mother and father are both dead, and they usually show up at least once or twice a month. These other gentlemen I was talking about earlier on the program, the guy RB will show up sometimes at least once a month or prior to somebody passing on. This, your friend Tom could actually be, it's like an unconscious form of communication, Ty. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, and in this other, for some people, they don't really grasp the fact that there's this other, it's like I tell people, I said, look, when we were kids and we looked under a microscope, we saw things we never saw before. You can't see with the naked eye. And I look at the same thing in life. There's these, like, and, you know, of course, Spaceboy and Surlana and Solaris brought my attention to this frequency situation, and I started thinking this vibrational, these vibrations that we may not be able to see with the naked eye. Sometimes you can sit somewhere and you swear you can see something moving out of the corner of your eye. Well, it's the very same thing with when people pass on. And it's interesting because I was watching the movie. Have you seen the movie Interstellar?
Not yet, no.
With Matthew McConaughey? You would probably enjoy that. But I was reading something, and I found this when I was doing some research on that movie. It says, during life, we perceive space-time in four dimensions, with time being unstoppable. One direction continues after death, and we return to our true selves in a five-dimensional bulk where time has no meaning. So this is where I start thinking for you, like me, that this 10-10 is some form of communication from your friend. Have you thought about that?
Yes, I have, actually, yeah.
Yeah, I think just like with me in the dreams, I'll get an image of the person usually, and it can be at various ages. Sometimes the dreamweaver, as I call her, the subconscious, will show me my parents at one stage of life versus another stage of life, and it'll do the same thing with these people from my past, you know, or celebrities who I've never met. You know, I'll see them, and sometimes they'll be shown older, or sometimes they'll be shown younger. And I have another thing I'm working on with all that. And I think this could possibly be a form of your friend Tom sort of communicating with you through these numbers as opposed to just showing you an image of dreaming. Are you a vivid dreamer by chance?
Yes, I am, actually, yeah.
Okay, here's what I'll make a suggestion to you. If you can get, do you have a photo of Tom?
Yes, I do.
Okay, try this, and I've worked with some other people with this very same thing. Take the photo and take a piece of paper or write on the back of the photo when he was born, when he died. Keep it that simple, and just when you're dozing off at night, just lay it on your solar plexus, put your hands over it, and see what comes through, and then just see what may come through while you're dreaming or sleeping, and just maybe have a journal. Do you journal? Do you write your dreams down?
No, but I do remember them quite well.
Okay. Well, maybe in this particular... What was that, sir?
Oh, maybe in this... Sorry.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, what I would suggest is maybe just for this experiment, just try this for a while. Don't put any time frames on it. Don't get discouraged if nothing happens immediately. And try this also. Take a notepad like I do and start recording when you see this 10-10 without effort. In other words, whenever, like, you may flip on the radio and there's a radio ad that suddenly says, and even keep in mind October 10th, if something says October 10th as opposed to just 10-10. Or if you're driving by or you take a different route and suddenly you're stopped at a light and you look up and on a billboard the last four digits of a phone number are 10-10. Or you flip on TV and the last four digits of some ad at that very moment or within moments flashes on and you see 10-10. And just see how often that occurs and write down the date and the time and the circumstance of how it occurred. And just see if there's some chain that's forming or so. I would be I would be very curious to see if your friend is trying to communicate to you.
I believe he is. I do. Shortly after he passed away, I think he contacted me in a dream through a phone call. I dreamt I was talking to him on the phone, and he told me that he was okay.
Mm-hmm. And I've had those dreams too. Recently,
I've been having dreams that he hasn't passed away, and that it's just a big scam. And I don't know if that's probably something maybe emotional that I'm going through, or. But it seems to me like he's still alive, but he's not in the picture.
Were you at his funeral?
I'm sorry?
Did you go to his funeral?
No, I wasn't able to because of a medical emergency. And I really regret that. But his wife did send me pictures and a little poster they had made of him with pictures of him and that sort of thing. Mm. So I've been in contact with his wife for a while.
Where did he reside?
He lived in the same city, Edmonton.
Oh, okay. All right. So this is somebody you saw on a regular basis?
Yes, and we've been friends for 38 years up until he died.
Yeah, that's just some of the ideas I can give you. I mean, it's always amazing to me because I remember the last time you called in, I was talking about 11/11, and then you had something very interesting happening with the 11/11 at the same time.
Yes, it turned out it was a disaster from the 11/11. Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that was when we had the fire.
Oh, yes. Ooh. Yes. Sure. You know what's interesting about that fire is the I had sent out, I had the song Wildfire repeating around me. You remember the Michael Murphy song?
Mm-hmm.
She ran calling Wildfire?
Yes.
Yes, I do,
yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and prior to that, I sent out a post to my private list, and I said, hey, this song, Wildfire, is repeating all over the place. I'm hearing it everywhere I go, and I posted it on the blog, and it was like 2 days later, or a day later, that fire, wildfire, that historical wildfire there in Canada happened.
Oh, is that right? Do you mean the Fort McMurray one?
Yes, the Fort McMurray. That's exactly what it was.
Wow. That's
Which
amazing.
Is interesting, because his name is Michael Martin Murphy. And it's Fort McMurphy. I mean, I was looking at all these little synchronicities, little connections to when that occurred. And I have friends that live in New York, and when I sent that to them, they said, oh, my gosh, we didn't even think about that. See, that's the thing with this stuff. It's never just one thing. And the mistake with it, when you hear some of these other people who predict the end of the world, and they put an outcome, and they put dates and all that. In my experience, you can't do that. You have to really see it as something more like possibilities or probabilities. And then you go down this list. And again, if anybody follows my blog, you'll see that I do this. And I think that's what a lot of people like and why they're tuning into it, because I'm not sitting there saying, hey, this person's going to die on this day and this is how it's going to happen. Because it's rarely like that. Even in the dreams, I explain that just the Dreamweaver wants my attention. So it's going to show me something with exaggeration. In the mini movie, as I call it, that shows me a compilation of all these fragments, throws all these fragments together. I'll give you an example, Ty. I had a dream about Sylvester Stallone, and he was on the FSU campus. Are you familiar with Florida?
Not really, no.
Well, you know where Tallahassee, Florida is?
Yeah, Tallahassee, sure, yeah.
Yeah, in the Florida Panhandle. And there's a real popular college there called Florida State University.
Okay.
And they have a really popular football team in the United States here, a college team. Anyway, in the dream, Sylvester Stallone and I were on the FSU campus, Florida State University campus. And there was some other activities going on, but I'm taking this one fragment out. If anybody was to go on the blog, you know, I don't want to have to read the whole thing. You can go to the blog and you can read, just put in Sylvester Stallone and look for Florida State University. Here's what happened, Ty. I think it was 3 or 4 days later, a big news story breaks. Sylvester Stallone is upset that his related stepbrother or brother, it was a relation of his, got beat up on the Florida State University campus. But what are the odds of that?
That is amazing.
This is the stuff that I post all the time on a regular, and you know, Spaceboy and Solana are aware of a lot of these, because I share a number of those with them. But and it is, and people, when they see this, you can't deny it, because this stuff is posted in advance. But I didn't say that Sylvester Stallone is going to be on the FSU campus. What that told me is I knew that the two fragments, that I knew Sylvester Stallone was being shown, and we're talking about Stallone tonight, so everybody pay attention. We might get a big news story about Sylvester Stallone. But the interesting thing is I do what I call a lotto card on him. His birthday is July 6th. So in addition, I'll say, okay, it's one of two things. I know there's going to be a high-profile news story on Sylvester Stallone, and I have an interesting story, Ty, so don't hang up. You'll like this. And then I said also there's going to be something with FSU campus. Then suddenly those two things merged together, and it was a news story dealing with his related relative getting beat up on the Florida State University campus where he goes to school. You can look it up in the news. There's no hoax going on here. This is all real. Now, what I wanted to tell you, Ty, another Sylvester Stallone story. Do we have time to talk about this, guys, or do we have a break?
Well, we've got two other callers trying to call in, but that's
okay. I'll tie it up real quick. When I was in the Army, my friend and I, this was back during the days when the first Rocky movie came out, and he was we're both fans of Sylvester Stallone in the movie Rocky. There's Rocky again for you, Surlana. It's come up again. Mm-hmm. So he told me, he said, you know, I would really like to meet him one day. Now, he didn't say he was going to meet him. He didn't have a big desire for it. Here's what happened. He's running and managing a gym in the middle of the desert in Yuma, Arizona in 1987. Suddenly, Sylvester Stallone walks in with his entourage and says, how much to work out for a month or so here? They were filming Rambo 3 in the desert right out there, and it took about 10 years for that to manifest, and here he is meeting his idol, and he sent me a Polaroid picture, and I have it. I've kept it to this day because I thought it was a great story. Now, he didn't relate. He remembered when I reminded him. I said, hey, you remember when you said that when we were stationed in Korea? He goes, yeah, but I didn't think about it until you reminded me of it. See, that's what happens. We have a tendency to forget these things, and then suddenly when it happens, we sort of have this trigger. But anyway, I thought you'd enjoy that.
That was that's amazing, yeah. Thank you very much, Patrick, for the information. And
absolutely,
Ty. Thanks, Space Boy and Surlana, for having me on.
No, we always enjoy having you on. In fact, as one of the callers tonight, you will be receiving Solaris Blue Raven's new book, A Million Miles Till Midnight. So,
along with some other stuff we meant to send you.
Yeah,
from before.
So you're going to get a box of goodies coming your way once it gets cleared through customs.
Excellent. I've forgotten about that because I was so absorbed.
Yes. So anyway, have a great evening.
Happy holidays to you, Ty.
And back to you, Patrick.
Okay.
And happy holidays, Space Boy and Surlana. And I'll say goodnight to all the space cadets as well.
Bye, Ty.
Bye.
Now, I have Fran and Bev, or Bob, or Bev and Bob.
That's a mouthful. So,
are you there, Fran?
It's Bev. Yeah, I'm here.
You don't mind being on together, do y'all?
No.
Fran was first, so if you've got any questions or comments for Patrick, you could go first, Fran.
Okay, well, the first thing I wanted to know was about dreams, number one, and whether or not, do you ever dream, or do you know anybody who dreams about being off-world and living, like, in a colony? Have you ever run into that?
I tell you what, before you answer that, let me go ahead and take the break now. And and because we are at the bottom of the hour, and when
don't
we come back,
don't talk about it during the break.
Yeah, and don't talk about it during the break because that we frown upon that here.
We're guilty.
Space. Yeah, and so usually the best stuff is during the break. So you're listening to. Hey, what are y'all listening to?
Spaceboy Network.
You've got it, Bev. It is the Spaceboy Universe Network, and we are being on the SBU Network. com, and so don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with our callers, Fran and Bev, and our special guest tonight, Patrick Sporer. So you got it. Don't tune out. You are listening to the SBUnetwork.com, and tonight is Spaceboy Universe night. And, of course, that was some Spaceboy music. How many Spaceboys can I get in tonight, right? So, tonight, our special guest is Patrick Sporer.
Patrick!
That's why I shouldn't be joking around. I need to be serious. I need to be on my game with Patrick, because...
I think he'll forgive you.
Yeah, appreciate it. So, yeah, Patrick Sporer. And we've got two lovely ladies on that I can't get their names wrong tonight. We've got Bev and Fran.
Our Fran and Bev.
So, ladies and gentlemen.
And Fran has the floor.
And yes, she does. Go ahead, Fran.
Okay. Anyway, the question was about that dream that I've had. And there's been several others very similar to it, where, and it looks like each one of them is on the same planet except for one. And one of them, there's like big, huge moons in the sky, like two or three of them. And the odd one was out the front of my apartment that I was in. The moons were out there, but on the back side, if I went to the back door and looked out, there was a huge, black, cracked, beaten up, burnt planet. Mm-hmm. And I've been really thinking about it a lot over the past, you know, this was quite maybe 5 months ago that I was having these dreams. And I was wondering if they could be anything other than a dream, that maybe I was actually there at some, maybe a concurrent timeline that didn't match up, or it was me in another lifetime being there.
Well, you know, is this Fran, right?
Yes, Fran.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Now, I just make sure I got it right. Yeah. Now, Fran, the interesting thing about this is when I dream, I've read about near-death experiences, you know, and people what they claim to have when they're having near-death experiences, because it seems like a lot of times my dreams, and I'm probably Surlana and yours as well, are probably as vivid, maybe even more so than these people that claim to have these near-death experiences, and they see all these things. Now, the interesting thing about that's the uniqueness and why I've said that collectively we all are little vessels of information, you know, we're getting messages, but sometimes the message can come in the form of like you're experiencing, and then mine comes in another way, and it could actually mean the same thing. Now, what makes me think about that planet was maybe a burnt-out sun. Did you ever think about that?
No, I hadn't gone there.
Well, the reason being is Nova
that they just exploded.
Well, I don't. We may not know that.
We don't know.
Maybe I read a
big charcoal thing in the sky.
Right. I read an article about that, and there was a fact. It was, I think, this last week. I saw where they said there was a sun that was burnt out, but it wasn't gone. It just went out, and it was just floating around out there, like you said, a giant piece of charcoal or something. Maybe possibly a moon. But this whole thing about traveling, you know, now see, again, when I break down a dream, I have to think, okay, for me, I would say, okay, I've had this vivid dream. Am I seeing the making of a sci-fi movie? Or am I going to be channel surfing? Am I going to be channel surfing and I run, you know, you're getting a future event, you're seeing something that's being shot in the future, or you may go to a movie in the future and say, wow, that's what I just saw in the dream. Now, that happens to all of us. You know, I was just thinking about that, or I just saw that in a dream not long ago. That's the thing I saw in my dream. This happens to me quite frequently where I'll just be channel surfing and I'll go, wait a minute, I saw that last night. I looked back at my notes and it's not anything that I posted, but it might have been a little sidebar thing. I said this or that. Now, a little over a year ago, I was in a meditation, and I saw, when I came out of the meditation, which is more like a trance state, I saw two planets colliding. And then suddenly, a few months later, after that dream, there were all these news stories about they thought that maybe the moon and Earth had once collided. And then there were these other stories about the moon was created and that Earth was a creation of two planets colliding and things like that. So I thought to myself, well, maybe that's what the dream was telling. Now, the other thing, could you be astral projecting is what you asked earlier? Is that what you asked?
Yeah,
Yeah, that's very possible. Now, I'm not an expert in that, but I have these dreams where I go other places. I swear, forward in the future, backward in the, you know, in the past. But am I really going backward or forward in our future past? Maybe I'm going to a parallel universe. Have you thought about that?
Yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking. I was seeing myself and becoming myself by projecting into that parallel universe. Because I know when I look in the mirror, it was my face. It was me.
Right. So, but you could be seeing your alter ego, and you're actually experiencing that connection, that subconscious connection, or that hive mind connection. That, like I said, that may not exist just in this world.
Yeah.
It could exist. And you're here experiencing what they're seeing.
Right. Okay. Yeah, that makes more sense to me. Because everything I've read about astral projection is, you know, everybody says, oh, there's this silver cord from your navel that connects you, and that's how you can get back. And nothing like that was happening.
Yeah, and I haven't had that happen either.
So maybe it was just I was projecting myself some other way into a parallel me.
Like I said, you're having a shared... Not necessarily a shared memory, but a shared experience. And when we go to sleep, like I said, when I read that a little bit ago about Interstellar, after I saw the movie Interstellar, it made me think about
That
when we're in this dreamlike state, it's almost like we have no bounds on us. We are...
Yeah.
It's kind of like in the movie The Matrix. You're free-floating. So, you know, that's what it sounds like to me. And I think I'm experiencing that same thing. But you sound like you're more of a natural towards it than maybe I am.
Yeah, because I've had, like I said, 3 or 4 of these over just this past year. And never before had I ever dreamt I was off-planet, but I've had the real vivid, you know, epic dreams, as I call them.
Let me ask you something. Have you tried to communicate with that other person, of yourself? Have you looked in that mirror and like wrote a message on the mirror or tried to communicate with them in some way?
Ooh. Yes, I have, as a matter of fact. In fact, I have a message up on my mirror right now, and I just realized it was still there. I hadn't washed it off yet.
Yeah.
And that was
a
few months ago.
I would keep experimenting with that.
That makes sense, big time.
Yeah.
Okay,
yep.
Well, thank you very much for your insights, because, you know, I just play it over my head and go, and I ask other people that I know, and they look at me like I'm nuts. You know,
I won't do
dream
that.
Dream about outer space?
I find it fascinating.
I think it's cool.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you, Patrick. I appreciate it.
Absolutely. I hope it was helpful.
Okay. Yeah, definitely. And so now I'll hand the floor over to my other self, Bev.
Sure.
Well, thank you,
Fran. Okay, I'm going to hang up now.
Okay, thanks, Fran.
Bye, you guys.
Bye, Fran. Okay, Bev, you're on.
Hi, Patrick.
Hey, how are you, Bev?
Oh, just fine. My question also is about dreams.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now, I don't think I dream because I don't remember my dreams. Now, does it mean necessarily that I dream, but I don't remember my dreams, or I just don't dream?
Well, that's a good question, because I have a friend who has the same issue, and I said, his name's Larry, and I've known him for years, and he worked out at my gym, and he actually sort of introduced me to my first psychic, but he's one of these guys that's sort of skeptical. He says he believes, and then he goes back and forth, but yet he lived in a house that was haunted and wrote a couple of books about it and everything else. But he says, hey, I never remember my dreams, and I go, no, don't say that to yourself. I said, you're dreaming, you just don't remember the dream. He goes, yeah, that's what I mean. Is that what you're talking about, Beth?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I believe you're dreaming. Now, what's happened to him lately, and this is like Surlana talked about, the repetition phenomenon earlier on the show, you know, he is now sending me dreams. He says, I'm remembering them now. He can't figure out why. I don't know why he's doing it, but he's also having the repetition phenomena happen, and he sent me two different email about digits that were recurring on the repetition, and both of those came in within days. The mistake was he quit playing, and I warned him. I said, whatever you do, don't quit playing, because those are going to hit, and they did hit. But it wasn't me that came up with the numbers on the repetition phenomena. It was him. And then, well, one of them was from a dream. The other one was repetition. So now, here he is, after all these years, suddenly, you know what he's doing? He's paying attention. Whereas before, he just sort of ignored. And this is what happens with a lot of people. All these things are happening to all of us. It's like I said, there are things happening, just like when we were kids and we looked under the microscope and we saw things that we never saw before and we were fascinated, but we can't see those things with the naked eye. And it's the same thing. When you start paying attention and you write it down, or you just jot down, I don't care if you remember, if you see an animal, write it down. If you see anything, because what it's going to do is your subconscious, the subconscious mind is the controller, believe it or not. Once you acknowledge your inner guide, I call it that sometimes, or the subconscious, or the dream wither, once you start acknowledging it, it's just like Spaceboy with his music. Spaceboy has a genius mentality for music, like my older brother does. And these guys have a crazy intuition that they can hear this entire symphony in their mind, like Mozart. The reason I joked about Mozart and the last time I called in Mozart and manifestation was because Mozart, supposedly his music has it was designed with this frequency to help free the minds of people at that time that were under tyranny. Well, it's the same thing. Once you start acknowledging your subconscious, it will start communicating to you. I've also discovered this with people who talk to themselves. My mother was a notorious talking to herself person, and I am too. But what I started noticing, and I was trying to show my last girlfriend, I said, look, I'm talking about this now. I'm going to prove it to you. Why did I suddenly start talking about this to myself? I jotted it down, and sure enough, it was connected to a future event. The subconscious has so many ways it tries to communicate to us, but so many of us try to dictate to it how it should communicate. See, Spaceboy has this amazing creative talent for the wonderful music that he plays. And it's like it's just pouring out of him to get it done, right? Well, it's going to be the same thing with you. That when you start just acknowledging, when you just start jotting these things down, and I don't mean just during sleep, I mean during the day, whenever you get an impression, the more you fuel your subconscious mind, the more it's going to start showing you things. And you're going to be open up to this whole new wonderful world, and you're going to ask yourself, what have I been missing? And I say that to myself every day. Oh, gosh, what am I going to miss? What am I going to miss? Does that make any sense?
Yeah, it does. It does. Now, see, before my dad died, I used to have visions. And they would be, I would see my dad in a casket in my dream, and someone in my family would die. And that used to scare the crap out of me. But since he's been dead now almost 17 years, but since he's died, I have not had that dream.
So it disappeared?
Yep.
It's a possibility that maybe you're going to start having some of these dreams again. Do you know, did you ever read the story about Abraham Lincoln, what happened to him prior to his death?
No.
This is heavily documented. He had all these visions of his death prior to it happening. He even wrote about it.
Oh, my.
And he had these prior to the assassination. But see, even he, as president, as wise as he was, he couldn't prevent the ultimate from happening. See, this is I go back and forth with this. And I know Surlana and Spaceboy understand what I'm talking about. If we're being shown a future event, then there's got to be a purpose to it, right? There's got to be some reason. Okay, so let's just say I'm having a dream, or you're having a dream, of a catastrophe of some nature coming, right?
Okay.
But let's say no matter how many people you try to warn, they're not going to listen to you. So you are getting the information for you.
Okay.
Bev is going to move out of the way of this disaster. That's going to happen and can't be stopped because it's in the future, but it can't be stopped. But Bev can save herself and her family. But the other people may be a hopeless situation, which is sad because that's what happens. A lot of people don't want to listen. They think somebody cries wolf or they say it's not going to occur. So that's what I said about future events. I have a friend who says, well, you always dream about negative stuff or write about negative stuff. I said, it's all how you want to look at it. That tells me something about that individual right away. Yeah, I said, why do I need to tell you about something good happening when that's going to happen anyway? You're going to embrace it. So what happens when I tell you something and you remember it for that brief moment, and instead of driving down this lane, you go, well, Patrick said this, I'm going to take this lane, and then you hear there was a 20-car pileup if you'd have went the other direction. You get what I'm saying, right? Yeah. So this is what I'm saying. Yeah, but it's not. See, this is again. I am not. I'm not a prophet. I'm just a regular person like everybody else. You know, Spaceboy has his talent for music. Surlana has her talent for research and reading. I just happen to be doing this at this time in my life. I was a business person for many, many, many years. Yes, I used my intuition and I got great stories. But now I'm trying to put it into some sort of cohesive understanding to share it with people. Because I want everybody to be able to go, hey, wait, yeah, I'm doing this too. We're not crazy. We're not, you know, it's not silly to know that this thing has been going on. And the great sages have wrote about this stuff for hundreds of years. You know, so Bev, you're going to start dreaming again, and you're going to start having these things again and just start jotting them down. And I hope the next time I'm on the show that you call in again and tell me about it.
Well, can you make yourself... how do I want to put it? Can you make yourself remember your dreams?
Sure.
Oh, really?
Yeah. You just program your subconscious before you go to bed. I tell you what you do. Okay. Write down your father's name on a piece of paper. Try this. And don't stop after one night. This is the problem. Don't put any time frame on it. Will you do that for me?
Okay.
Don't. You're going to promise me you're not going to quit.
I won't quit.
Okay.
I promise.
I want you to write your father's name down and when he was born and when he died, just like a tombstone, like you would look at it. And I want you, when you go to bed at night, I want you to think of your father and lay that over your solar plexus.
Okay.
And then let's see what happens, okay? Just that simple. This simple exercise, and then you're going to graduate from there.
Okay. That sounds neat.
And there's another thing I want you to do. Whenever you start seeing a number repeat or a name repeat, don't worry about an outcome. Just jot it down. Just jot it down the time and the place where you saw it, okay?
Okay, I sure will. And I
what? Because
I
thank you for the question.
Well, thank you for the info and trying to, you know, help me.
well, Bev, I can tell you this stuff.
I always thought I was crazy for not remembering my dreams.
No, you're not crazy. You're not crazy.
Well, my husband would beg to differ with you.
Now, he said he was going to help you, make sure you kept going with it.
You what, Surlana?
He said in the chat he wasn't going to let you not do it. He was going to keep doing this experiment.
Okay.
At least that's what I got. Well, now he's committed. Now he has to.
Yeah, I do. And I am going to do that.
Okay.
Bev, you have a great holiday, okay?
Well, you too, and thank you.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye,
Surlana.
Bye, Bev.
Bye, Bev. Hugs and kisses.
Bye.
Well, hugs and kisses to you guys, too.
And we'll be sending you a copy of Solaris' Blue Raven's book, A Million Miles Till Midnight. So expect that soon for you, okay?
All right.
Awesome.
And thank you.
All right.
Yep. Love you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye, Beth. I just want to remind everybody that I'm not making any money on the blog. I'm not trying to get people to go there just to what I want you to do is you use it as a learning tool. If you go there, you read something, it may or may not resonate with you, but it's just like Surlana said. You know, now she's starting to notice these things, maybe not with the frequency I am, but she's at least giving it an opportunity. So it's just like if you go to the blog and start visiting it, you'll see, you'll get an idea of how these things are constructed.
Mm-hmm. So we're at the top of the hour, and we got the chance to ask you if you wouldn't mind staying, and you agreed to stay a little bit longer. So let's take a quick break, and we've got another person on hold. Don't go anywhere, caller. And of course, we know who you are, and you'll probably fill out another 2 hours with this. So you're listening to SBUnetwork.com, and this is the Spaceboy Universe show. So don't go anywhere.
it's not in Texas.
We're back, and Surlana's just loving Texas left and right here. And you're listening to Spaceboy Universe, and we're on the SBUnetwork.com. And our guest tonight has been wonderful and gracious enough to stay with us a little bit longer, Patrick Sporer. And we have a caller on the phone, and that is Dino. Hello, Dino.
Good evening, good folks, and good evening, guest Patrick. I just wanted to mention, you know, Bev brought up the point right when I called in. She brought up the point that I was going to make from my education, looking into dreams and neurology and such, that we absolutely can, when I studied Carlos Castaneda years ago, that's when I learned that we can influence our dreams, or at least before we go to sleep, we can ask that we remember important things about our dream. And if you start doing that every night, I stopped doing it years ago, but if you want to, if you're having a difficult situation in life, you do that, and you will remember a lot of things. And the second point I wanted to mention is that dreaming is necessary for our neurological health. I mean, it really is, from everything I've learned, excuse me, medically, it's important. A lot of people say, well, I don't dream, or I don't remember my dream. Well, you do dream. You have to. If you get more than 5 or 6 hours a night, you're going to go into REM, R-E-M sleep, and it's essential. People who are deprived of sleep will lose their minds and finally their life if kept away from dreaming.
That's like that episode of Star Trek The Next Generation where Troy can't sleep and she starts to lose it.
Yes, and all they were trying to tell her was the other alien ship couldn't communicate. Mm-hmm. They were in some anomaly plasma, and they were trying to tell her two eyes floating in the dark. They were trying to tell her hydrogen would solve the problem.
Mm-hmm. It's a great episode. I think it's great. It's more of the obscure episodes, but it's awesome that you know that episode.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know hydrogen, H2O.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, Dino. I couldn't agree with you more. Unless, of course, you're having nightmares, and then dreaming might not be too healthy.
That's what she was having, or she thought she was having, was the nightmare.
Yeah, that's the thing. There are people that do have... just for a brief moment, is Catalina still in your chat, or did she sign up?
Don't know. It's been a while since she's posted, if you're still out there.
That broad is always hanging out.
posted 4 minutes ago.
Well, she's... Oh, is it that delayed? Oh, okay, I didn't know that. She had something on there called shapeshifters or something on there. And what was so interesting about that is this is another thing I do while I'm watching you, listening to you guys and watching the chat. I've had things jotted down here that I glanced at today. And on my bulletin board, I was putting something up, and for some reason I looked at shapeshifter. And then suddenly Catalina has it sitting there right in front of me on the chat. So interesting. And then I was listening about werewolves earlier today. So, I don't know. Maybe we're going to have a werewolf story out there. Dino, are you a werewolf?
No, I'm not into werewolf stuff. I'm a bunny. but I'm a bunny rabbit. But I will tell you that nightmares, I've often wondered about. I don't get them often much anymore. But I've had some struggles in life coming up. Especially when my mother died many years ago. And she should have lived longer, and I'm an only child, so I've had to deal with a lot of stuff myself. Luckily, every so often through life, I've had some really good friends. Some of them are still with me, but, you know, things change, and I've wondered about nightmares. I mean, it seems to me that if you're having a lot of nightmares, your waking life is not going well, and things, you know, your subconscious mind is trying to tell you, this is not right. This is out of balance.
Well, that is a possibility. I have to tell you, I rarely have what I call a nightmare. Every once in a while, I think the last time what I could call a nightmare, I'm trying to recall it, I was caught up in the blue beam of a UFO. And it was so realistic, and this is when I lived in my apartment. This was quite a while back, maybe 15, 20 years ago. And it was so unbelievably real that when I woke, I could have swore that I had elevated from my bed as if I was being pulled up by this blue beam. And then suddenly I remember a voice in my head saying, just say this prayer and the blue beam will break. And so I remember saying that prayer, and next thing I know, I had a waterbed at that time, and I remember I slapped, and I thought, what happened? I woke up and my heart felt like it was going to beat out of my chest. Mm. It was such a real experience, but I'm still in my apartment now, so I'm not claiming I was being, you know, pulled up, but this was before I ever was aware of blue beams or this happening with UFOs. That was the other thing, because not long after that, I remember seeing a program. Now, that dream could have been indicating a future event that I was just going to see that. I'm not claiming I was abducted or anything like that. But that's what I recall maybe as a nightmare for me. But I don't really have nightmares where there's creatures chasing me or you know, anything necessarily that dramatic in that way. Surlana, do you have anything like that?
What do you mean, like... Yeah, I get things chasing me. Creatures, people, monsters, the apocalypse, nuclear bomb. I mean, dreamed about Satan the other night, come in and make us all his minions and take over, turn us into monsters. I don't even know if I call these things nightmares anymore. They're just regular insanity. And then I'll have your regular dreams where I'm in a public place and I can't find a restroom that's in a decent working condition, or it's too dirty to go. Or, you know, I've shown up to work and they've moved my office to a basement, like an office space, and I don't know if I work there anymore, and I don't have a stapler, and, you know, things like that. You know, the usual anxiety, worry, dreams. I'm being sent back to high school as a 44-year-old woman because my mother thinks I didn't actually learn anything the first time. She's been deceased for a while. So it's just, it's everything. It's almost everything you can think of, except... UFOs and paranormals, not that too much.
Well, if I could mention, I wanted to mention that in the kind of Charles Dickinson sense, I have to admit that when I have had them, and I had a lot more nightmares when I was younger years. As I've gotten older, maybe I'm more balanced in my life. When something bothers me, it really bothers me, and I'm honest about it, so I don't dream about it, you know. So in a Dickinson sense, I sometimes feel just like Scrooge said, you know, when the ghost came to him, he said, you're nothing more than a piece of undigested meat, you know. I really think that if you eat something that's not good for you, especially if you eat late at night, you eat rich foods, that's when I've tended to have nightmares, you know. You wake up and if your heart is burning or you're having an esophageal burning, you're going to have a dream about someone chasing you with fire, you know.
Well, that's interesting. You know, I, as another part of this experiment with me and dreams and stuff, I will experiment with different foods before I go to bed. I'm experimenting right now with honey and hot cocoa because I read somewhere from way back somebody talked about, I don't know where I saw it, but it was like hundreds of years ago where this was supposed to be a way to enhance your dreams. But I can't honestly say that I have had that experience yet, and I've been doing this about a month now. But I've experimented. Go ahead.
Well, I don't want to ask you to hold up because you might hang up on me. But I wanted to say that that is true, what you said about the food. I remember many years ago, I was living in a place where there was an Indian restaurant. And this Indian restaurant, I don't eat that kind of food, but I was invited to have a free meal there. Well, it wasn't really an Indian restaurant. It was run by a group of, I think they were Rajneesh devotees. You know, they were Americans that followed this guru, Rajneesh, who later, you know, he was a big hustler. He drove around in Rolls Royces and slept with the American women and all. But, you know, people thought he had some good things to say. So I went to their restaurant, and they offered me, I guess they were trying to recruit me, but I don't recruit well. and I ate this food, and it was, I have to admit, it wasn't too bad. It was all plant-based, and I think some of it might have had soy. I don't eat soy anymore. But that night when I went home, I'm going to tell you, I had no gas. I slept well. It was an easily digestible meal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and again, I like I said, I'm not opposed to experiment outside of using drugs, but I've experimented. I've read where taking an aspirin before bed will help open up the blood flow to your brain. It's supposed to help you take it with warm water. So some people can try something as simple as that.
Well, you don't even need to go with the pharmaceuticals. I drink. I used to not drink because, of course, we have to get up to pee at night, you know. But I drink warm tea, not hot. The warm tea almost every night now when it's not hot weather, and it's usually decaffeinated green tea or chamomile. And I must say, I don't really like it, but every so often, I have to get up in the middle of the night. I kind of sleepwalk to the bathroom, do my business, and go back to sleep. But I read that having not alcohol, but having a liquid before you go to bed also helps your brain to clean out, to get rid of the bad cholesterol and such.
Here's something you might want to try, Dino, if you have the time. And Surlana, let me just add, before I say that, and then remind me, Dino, what I was going to tell you, but Surlana made me think of something there. Now, Surlana, you're a very vivid dreamer like me. Have you noticed the time of night when you have these dreams, when they wake you up or anything? Have you noticed around the time that occurs?
I'm going to guess they happen after, if I can get this, that's the main problem, is getting to sleep, after 2 a.m. And for some reason, if I take a nap during the day, if I stay home sick or today, like today, if it's during the daytime, those are even more intense. And I don't know why.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting because I have that happen when I have these little naps like yourself. Mm-hmm. I always try to say if I have a dream or something that I post, I'll say this came from a nap as opposed to a dream. But something I've been experimenting with, because I can do that now because I'm retired, but I'll sometimes just stay up real late, you know, like watching movies or binge watching, and then I'll go to bed when I'm real, real, real tired. I mean, I'm talking the kind where, you know, you're just not going to stay up no matter what you do. And I've noticed that I have extremely clear and heavy dreams when I do that. And then I've experimented also with this where I'll go to bed early. And early for me is 1 or 2 in the morning. Mm. And then I'll make myself wake up around 4. And then I'll make myself stay up. And then when I doze off after that, Solana, these dreams are like reality. I mean, like just incredibly crisp. But those are some suggestions. I know that everybody doesn't have the luxury of doing that, like I'm experimenting with some of this stuff now. But this shows you that I'm not, you know, this is no play toy to me. This is something I really enjoy doing. It's like your show, and it's like Space Boys music. You know, I have a passion for this, and I'm going to experiment. I'm going to do different things. And I don't know if I'll ever write a book about it. I'll continue to blog about it. And I always enjoy being on your show and talking to people like Dino, like right now. He always has great questions and great feedback. Dino, what was the last thing you asked me, or did I answer?
Well, we were talking about what you might drink or take before you go to bed to help make you sleep better so you can go into REM sleep.
Well, yeah. Well, like I said, I'm experimenting now with hot chocolate and honey. But I can't honestly say that I still have to do more experimentation. Like I said, this isn't something you can just do a couple of nights and quit and say, well, it didn't work. It may take months, you know, to figure it out. But I usually give it ample time. Now, other things I've used, like I said, I've tried the aspirin. But you got to remember, for people like Surlana and I, and possibly yourself, we're natural dreamers. So it may be that we don't really need anything. It may be that it's just part of our DNA, you know, or maybe both of us got wrapped on the head coming out of the womb or something, and this is some sort of, you know, side effect from that.
Well, I did want to ask you something about precog, but right before I ask that, if I may, you know, dreaming is necessary, and we all do it. If we're not doing it, it's not good for our health. But I was wondering, what really bothers me, aside from those powers that be, we're supposed to be in America, you know, a free, semi-democratic country, but it's getting worse and worse. More people are reporting on this, scientists, doctors, just statistics. If you look at emergency calls, people in America that are employed are not getting enough sleep. They're making us work harder. Well, without getting into politics, the current incoming administration is talking about taking away certain overtime benefits. I really am worried because I still have to commute sometimes on a freeway, And they've proven that people, if they even have less than 7 hours sleep each night, get into more fatal car accidents. And I have to drive next to these, you know, zombie clowns, you know? I try to make sure I get at least 7 or 8 a night. And some people say, oh, I only need 5. BS. If you're not getting it there, you need to get it somewhere else. If you can divide to twice a day, some people can do that. Some can't. But you need sleep. And the other thing is these kids, these teenagers and middle school kids, we have them go into school too early, and they're not learning, and everybody blames the teachers. But, you know, part of it is if the kid's half asleep, kids need sometimes 10 hours sleep. They're still developing and growing till they're in their early 20s. And so everything we're talking about, sleep is important, dreaming is important. But what I wanted to ask you, Patrick, I didn't pay as close attention as I should have tonight. Your precog abilities, they are dependent upon your dreaming, or do they just come to you as a thought during the day?
Well, both. Yeah, I have just as many things. Like I said, the repetition phenomena is one of those. I have impressions that I'll just have of it. But again, I'm not trying to separate myself from people, Dino. I want you to understand, never will you hear me exalt myself and say, I'm the only person that can do this. Or, no, what I'm about is encouraging all of us to enhance our abilities by sharing our experiences with one another so that we can, we can learn from one another and everybody can apply their talent. It's just like I said, the Spaceboy, you know, I wanted to, Spaceboy, like, let's use him as an example. The question to Spaceboy is, tell me how a piece of music comes to you.
Well, music comes at me different directions. It can be from a casual conversation with Surlana, or maybe it comes from emotion, like something makes me sad or angry, or or something I'm watching inspires me to, you know, I really like that way that sound. Let me see if I can reproduce that sound.
Sometimes I'll give you a song title I thought up, and that'll set you off.
So it comes from different. I mean, it's organic. It's everywhere. That's the best way to describe it. It comes from everywhere and anything.
Right. Exactly. That's a great answer, and that's exactly the same thing I think Dino was searching for there. The thing is, it does. It comes from all kinds of different mediums. And I just happen to be able to pick up on a lot of different things. It's like I go to a movie. Believe me, if I go to that movie, I'm there with a notepad, and I sit away from people somewhere where there's light, so I can take notes and pick up on the subtle cues that I pick up on in this film to see what's repeating or why am I really sitting at this movie. I think, like you said earlier, we live in a distracted world, Dino. You would agree with that, right?
Yes.
Okay, and because of that distracted world, more people are dying. Because innocent people are dying. Now, look how many bus wrecks we've had in just the last, 3 weeks? Have you been keeping up with that stuff?
Yeah,
I mean,
exactly.
These are innocent people being killed because of distracted driving or people not getting enough rest. We're in a world where there's so much static and so much stuff going on now that it is difficult for people to get proper rest.
And it affects your health not only in a psychological way, but people are dying earlier. You're more likely to have a stroke or a heart attack if you're not getting enough rest and downtime. I mean, we're designed, I believe, and I may be wrong, but we're designed to be a third awake, you know, for working, a third awake for recreation, and a third awake for sleep, 8 hours a day. But they tell us, oh, you don't need 8 if you're an adult. Okay, 7, but they do say 7 minimally. And so not only are there airplane crashes, but, you know, I'm driving down the highway. This is one of my big beefs, and I have a close friend who's a nice guy, but he tells me, oh, I don't like to use my signal because when I'm on the freeway, because, you know, you hit the signal and then people speed up. And I go, you're going to cause a wreck. What I do is I turn my signal when I have to merge a lane, and I match the speed of the car next to me, and I go behind it. But everywhere I drive, every morning to work or places, people always want to beat you. If you're doing 65 or 70, they got to do 75 and cut in front of you without signaling.
Oh, don't come to Houston, Dino.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, Well, yeah, but you know, we're kind of getting off point, but I'm glad you brought that up. Did you see what just happened in New Orleans this last week? Yeah. See, the road rage. People are losing their tempers a lot easier. I kind of plan my day where I don't have to be around crowds. I don't like going on the highway when it's rush hour traffic. I try to stay away from anywhere because there are, and especially now that we're entering, I'm glad you brought this up, Dino. We're entering Mercury retrograde in the full moon phase. Now, I don't know how many people even believe in that stuff, but I have, other than dreams, I've kept files and researched this Mercury retrograde. And you got to remember, Mercury retrograde and full moon phases are not some otherworldly thing. This is something that's been studied for many, many years, and the Farmer's Almanac even recognizes. So,
right.
You know, it's not just some run-of-the-mill thing that some have. And when we're in the midst of those things, it gets even worse. And the first thing I noticed that when every single time, and I wanted to bring this up to Solana's point about suggestion, because she makes a good point that I've studied that aspect, too, not to suggest to myself that, well, it's Mercury retrograde. Oh, gosh, there's going to be all this crazy chaos because of that. No, this is something and you know, that's why you have to be aware, and she brought up a really good point in the show. You have to be aware so that you don't allow a suggestion to maybe trigger something inside of you. Wouldn't you agree with that, Surlana?
I'm just pleased I made a good point.
I think so. I think you made an excellent point. But anyway, so with Catalina, for instance, she says her Mercury is her ruling planet, which means she's either a Gemini or a Virgo. So what she has to watch, of course, it doesn't just affect Virgos or Geminis. It affects everybody across the board. And during these certain times, when you have the Mercury, and I'll give you an example. This is a great example. Do you remember what happened on December 26, 2004? Anyway, it's a rhetorical question. it was the Indonesian tsunami, earthquake and tsunami.
Oh.
That happened on the full moon, exactly on the full moon.
I was going to say something about the moon.
Well, it happened exactly on the full moon during a Mercury retrograde intersection. Now, Hurricane Sandy, same thing happened. I have watched this for years, and if people want to say they don't believe in it, that these things happen all the time. Yes, I will agree. Things do happen all the time. But during a Mercury retrograde, and especially during a Mercury retrograde full moon phase, things seem to intensify. And I'll give you an example. I had a friend who worked in the ER, and he heard me talk about this in my gym a lot. And he said, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to do an experiment. He said, I'm going to study this phase when you say, he asked me when this phase was. And I said, it's these dates. And he says, then I'm going to study these phases and see if there's more or less accidents. He came back and he said, okay, during these 3 weeks, it's actually longer than 3 weeks, but we'll say the full bore phase is 3 weeks of Mercury retrograde. Now, this didn't contain the full moon. He said, between the time of that and the time when it wasn't, he said we had three times as many people coming in with accidents than we did during the non-Mercury retrograde phase. Same thing. I had a friend who's a police officer. He didn't care about any of this stuff. He said, look, I'll do an experiment too. Three times to four times as many arrests over crazy accidents, people going nuts, than they did during the out-of-phase time. Now, they still had things happen. Now, that's one of this is the mistake when people are listening to me talk about this. They go, no, wait a minute. Those things happen all the time. I go, yeah, earthquakes, all these things, yes, they do happen all the time. But during these phases, these Mercury retrograde, and sometimes with the Mercury retrograde full moon phases, it seems like more historical things, accidents, catastrophes, things like that occur during these phases. I mean, big. And as an example, Solana, you remember the last supermoon we had?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, it was last month, right?
Yeah, I remember seeing it in the morning. I was look at that moon. It's showing off.
Spaceboy, do you remember it?
Yeah, I do too, because it was so apparent when we got up in that morning.
Right. Now, there hadn't been one in, like, it was the first supermoon since 1948.
Right.
Right, right.
Okay, and what I did is I posted online, because I did research on that, before the New Zealand earthquake occurred, I said it's very possible with this super full moon that we are going to experience another place getting rocked by a major earthquake similar to what happened in 1948. One day, to the day the supermoon occurred, since 1948 was that huge New Zealand earthquake. There was an 8.3 back then on that date, almost in, not in the exact zone, but in the South Pacific area, that same general area. But what are the odds of that? I mean, you can't think that's a coincidence, right?
Well, you bring up a good point, Patrick, that I real quickly, I didn't really believe in astrology. It was my mother. My mother was into astrology, and she'd tell me stuff, and I'd listen to it. And then when I got out of college, I'd had some scientific training, you know, and I said, oh, that's all silly and all. But as I observed, like you said, there's a lot of disinformation out there. But I had read years ago that police departments, hospitals claim that during full moons they get increased calls and wacky calls and more bleeding on the operating table. But then a few years ago, I don't know if it's different disinformation, someone else said they did a study and said, oh, that's not true, it's not significant. But it seems to be. I've talked to cops, you know, I don't know a lot of cops, but that I've known, they go, oh, yeah, full moon. They'll even make the statement, is it a full moon tonight if they get too many weird calls? And the fire departments, same thing. And then, you know, that supermoon you talked about, yeah, it was closer to us than anything. So was that a physical influence? Is it our pineal gland? Does it have to do with light and stimulating our hormones? All I can say is that after many years, I'm back to believing that, yes, full moons are a significant kind. Be aware, extra aware, because people are a little bit more amped up no matter what you're doing. And what you mentioned about the Mercury retrograde, it happens 3 times a year, every year at different times. And I was told never get into a legal contract or a complicated communication beginning at that time. And I have found that to be true. Like right now I'm trying to get involved with signing a contract. If it doesn't come through, I mean, when does Mercury go retrograde? I think this week. I'm going to just hold off until 3 weeks and tell them hold off. Because I've experienced things falling apart in Mercury retrograde.
Well, yeah, electronics, mechanical stuff, communication. People get upset with each other. They say the wrong things. Just like I'm trying to be very careful tonight what I say because of the fact that I know things can be taken out of context. It's really strange. And a lot, you'll see politicians watch news shows. You'll see that they'll have audio and visual problems, local news. You'll see all this during Mercury retrograde. But I want to bring up this point. We have a full moon on the 14th of this month. And we have Mercury retrograde on the 19th. That's very close. Let's just see over the next 2 weeks if we get any major earthquake. We've already had 4, and we had a real bad one in Indonesia the other day, almost in the same exact area as the 2004 December 26th earthquake. So it'll be interesting to see, or if we have any major water events, tsunamis, or if there's any kind of crazy stuff. But
that is interesting that you mentioned. I'm just saying it's interesting that you mentioned that because I was looking at an earthquake map on the Internet just the other day, and in the last week or two already, we've had like 3 or 4 significant earthquakes. They were above 6 point, you know, 7 point, and they've all been around the Pacific Rim all the way around.
Except the one in Trinidad. But that happened earlier in the week. But you're right, the other ones have. But anyway, I know that it's getting late and everybody's probably getting tired. I could talk for any longer if there's anybody else wants to call in. There's no rush, but I appreciate it, Dino. You always have interesting stuff you bring up. You're a very knowledgeable guy, and I hope when I'm on again.
Well, thank you for talking to me. I guess that's time for me to bow out, right, Space and Surlana?
That's all right, Dino. I feel like the two of you could go on together for a while.
It almost reminds me of a recent Facebook post I've seen where it has the thing from Amazon, the little pod thing that you can order, and then there's a Google one out,
Echo,
and they put them face to face, and then they kind of just fed off of each other and going back and forth.
It never stops.
But that's always good, though. But two of my favorite people to talk to is Patrick and Dino. So there's always something interesting from both of y'all. So Dino, thanks for stopping by and making our night.
As always, I'm not there just to talk. I'm hoping it's interesting and to the show.
Yes, it's always interesting.
Hey, Dino, trust me, it's interesting. And the problem for me is, as with Spaceboy, I could talk to you guys for hours. But I know that we have to stop at some point.
Okay, let's do it again sometime. Good night, all.
Good night, Dino.
Sounds good.
All right. So, do we have anything else in the log there? No? Mm-hmm. Are we good? Well, Patrick, let's tell our audience, if they want to reach out to you and find you. And I know I've said it at the beginning in your intro and your bio, but tell people where they can find you and all that good stuff.
Well, primarily the blog address is patrick-patrickscott.blogspot.com. Same address it's been for 9-point-something years since first developed it. Now, the only thing I always remind everybody, that I haven't just been posting dreams and having dreams since 2007 when this started. I've had this experience since I was a child. At the urging of a friend is why I started doing the blog. I've been keeping dream journals and all of that stuff for, close to 35 years, maybe even longer than that. I post daily. And I give you different ideas, and so it's maybe you can use it as a learning tool and some form of entertainment. And I appreciate if you visit and share it, and you can always let Surlana and Spaceboy give them feedback on how you enjoyed the show tonight. And I want to wish everybody a safe and happy holiday through this Mercury retrograde and full moon phase.
Well, Patrick, thank you for stopping by again. Surlana, do you need to add anything to that?
I don't know if this is Dino's talking about Patrick. He's saying, what, no book? So I'm thinking maybe that's a sign that... that he needs to get one together.
Get a book together of your greatest hits, so to speak?
I don't have any... I think he wanted a book from Solaris. That's maybe what he was talking
about. Is he saying that on the chat? Can we get a confirmation?
That's what he meant. But I still think Patrick needs a book, too.
Well, yeah, Patrick, you need a book. But real quick, Dino, you'll need to send your contact information to contact@spaceboyuniverse.com, an address, and we'll get you a copy of Solaris's book, A Million Miles Till Midnight. And I guess it's been a million miles to midnight tonight for Solaris, and because we love her to death, as I'm sure you do, Patrick. She's just a wonderful individual, and we wanted to show our support and love for her by promoting her book by giving them away tonight.
Yeah, well, hey, I want to thank you too again for it was a great. I feel it was a great show. It went smooth, went fast.
Yeah,
enjoyed talking to you guys as always, and you're great hosts. And I wish you happy holidays, and I pray that your dog returns to you. That would be great.
That would be a nice gift.
That'd be a miracle.
Yeah. But Patrick, thank you. And just hold right there as we finish off. So at this point, say goodnight, Surlana.
Goodnight, Surlana.
Goodnight, guys.
Spaceboy Universe is hosted by Spaceboy and Surlana. Executive producer is Surlana. Social media producer is Dennis Koch. Associate producer is Lee Ann Cordes. Music production is Spaceboy of SpaceboyMusic.com. Special thanks goes out to Lee Ann K, K28, Mark S, and Bob N. This has been a Spaceboy Universe production. Support the universe by exploring Spaceboy Universe with Spaceboy and Surlana. Sweet dreams, Space Cadets.